Tech Shooter here. I want to tell you about the new used Ride Emporium. They'll take any existing ride or attraction and make it into anything else you'd like, regardless of theme and location and whether it makes any sense or not. If you want your ride changed, giddy up, partner. It'll happen. You won't need to pony up too much loot either. Ooh, I've got cheap overlays running through me. You want to turn your mine train roller coaster in your frontier-themed area into a train through a futuristic robot war? No problem. You want to re-theme your carousel to an attraction based on Quentin Tarantino's Pulp Fiction? Why not? You want to take an alpine bobsled and turn it into a space disaster? Maybe that one's too much of a stretch. New used Ride Emporium will do anything. If you've got an idea, it can be brought to life with as much wood, plastic, and molded fiberglass crap as it takes. Adding junk and screens to pass off as a new theme is our specialty. First-hand customers are guaranteed to have certified Main Street lumber used in the project. Yep, quality stuff there. So come on down to the new used Ride Emporium. Bring the enthusiast in your life. There's plenty of past ride relics in our warehouse to be senselessly and pointlessly strewn about a future queue. Hey, I remember that. Yeehaw! This ride must be great now. New used Ride Emporium. For when you want that new experience with a familiar feel, and you don't really care about how it looks or fits, leave your guests feeling delighted and amazed and newly used. New used Ride Emporium cannot guarantee park goers will forget the original attraction theme.
We're back. Welcome to another exciting episode of Thanks for Writing. What do we have for them today?
It's time to talk to death all of the new to us stuff in California in the past,
Five's a magic number.
5 years, okay.
We did a Florida episode like this.
Yeah.
Or two or three episodes, whatever the hell it ended up being last year. We're going to start. Where are we going to start? Start in heaven?
Start with.
What was some of the best stuff?
That was.
You want us to go in order?
Yeah.
What we did?
I think that's the easiest thing to do.
All right. And we'll just kind of have highs and lows as we go.
Yeah.
Knott's Berry Farm.
What was new?
What was new?
Last 5 years. Voyage to the Iron Reef.
Yeah. That was the first thing we did.
Yeah, that was. Yeah.
That whole adventure, that was the very first ride we did. I don't know, lackluster.
It was actually a little better than I thought it was going to be. I was setting the bar really low in my mind.
Well, it's like a little background. Yeah, this was Cedar Fair's attempt at a dark ride adventure. They did the first one in Canada, Canada's Wonderland, and then this was the second and last, right? It's only two.
That was it, yeah.
So just the way it worked out, like we thought it was probably going to be awful because they didn't bother to do any more after this. So, you know, you're thinking it's gotta suck, right? And then, yeah, on that, going in with that feeling, yeah, it did actually, it was better. It was better than we thought.
I remember, I think as we were riding through it, I think maybe you said, it works. Like, it just actually works.
Oh, the system works really well.
Just
yeah.
Like on the baseline level that the guns actually shoot and the targets are hit on the screen and all that stuff and registers and
yeah,
that stuff works.
It works. And that level is just as good as the Sally Justice League rides.
Right.
It works.
Yeah, I don't know. Do the cars actually have movement, though?
It's like, I don't
remember. I want to say no, but I'm not sure. They definitely turn.
They just turn. That's it.
All right.
Yeah. It's more Midway Mania.
Oh, okay.
Than
okay.
Spider-Man.
Gotcha. Right. Oh, yeah, and then this is from Triotech, I believe, right?
This is a Triotech, yes.
Canadian company.
It's fine.
And the first thing I noticed was that it looked a little flimsy because the ride car, when they have to like push the entire front of it, they have to like separate the front of it to get people in there.
It's a really weird restraint and just entry exit system, yeah.
And the whole car, like, wobbles when the thing opens and closes.
Yeah,
it's all one big piece of cheap fiberglass, thin fiberglass or something.
There's no build-up. It's the old dark ride repurposed from Knott's Berry Farm. It's what they always had.
Right.
Same queue, same building. They dressed it up a little bit, I think, maybe just in the largest waiting area. of the queue, but it's still pretty bare bones overall. You're just kind of walking up ramps and then, you know, yeah, you get in and then it's a video game.
Yeah.
That was my takeaway. It just this really did feel like a video game.
Just shooting at screens, there's no actual sets.
Yeah, there's not much of a story that's set up. As that first room, it's like you're submerging, I guess.
Yeah.
You're supposed to be underwater the whole time, right? It's some kind of submarine, you're in a submarine. And then that's it. It's a video game. It's video game quality graphics. Good video game quality graphics, but still.
Sure.
And then it even has like the boss battle.
Yeah.
The finale has like a boss battle, and it's very much like a level of a video game.
It has kind of a steampunk edge to it. You're shooting like mechanical fish or something. That's a little weird.
Oh, yeah.
I guess they didn't want you to shoot actual fish. I don't know.
That's it. That's much else to say about it. It's
kind of okay at best.
It wasn't really thrilling, but it wasn't awful either.
Yeah.
It does come together and it works. It's fine.
But Justice Leagues are better.
Yeah, it's still Justice League, though. That is a much better attraction.
I think, even though I don't really care for Midway Mania, I even like that better.
Yeah. I like Midway Mania better.
And it's
the worst of these.
yeah, it is. And I like the Boo Blasters better too, because they actually have like, you know, real sets and props and stuff, and that's nice. Just 100% pure screens
is kind of,
I don't know. It's hard to get behind for me.
Yeah. So just okay, I guess not as bad as we thought, but.
Yeah. Well, I'd never read really anything very good about this.
Yeah, that's another thing too. It's like, yeah, but it's just okay.
But it's okay, right? Yeah, it's fine.
It's just fine. And I think the final thing I said as we were exiting was like, Cedar Point should get one of these, the park that really does need something that's not a roller coaster,
definitely.
Just to round the day out. And this is fine. It's good enough.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I'm gonna give it a different theme there.
I mean, really, with Cedar Point, they should just call Sally and get their own version of Justice League.
Or, yeah, just do that.
Just theme it to something else.
Snoopy League?
Yeah, Snoopy League.
I don't have any characters.
You're shooting the Peanuts characters?
Well, they are annoying.
or are you shooting the adults?
Everybody just faceless. Likes, oh, like the legs?
Wow, wow, wow.
You just see the legs. Oh, no. Wow, wow, wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, they should just call Sally to do that. All right. What else we got? What else did we do that was new?
Soul Spin.
Oh, that was good. That was fine.
Mondial Top Scan.
Those are coming. Not even back, but they're coming for the first time, which is a good thing. Best flat ride ever, I think. We think. The show thinks, according to this show. Listen to our flat ride episode. You can hear all about that.
Yeah, and it's good.
And this is. I think that actually it's a slightly larger model.
Oh.
I think there's an extra seat in each row, I believe. The arms are one seat longer.
Oh, okay.
I think it's five, and these are six.
Oh, damn.
But that didn't really register for me. I didn't really get... If you didn't tell me, I would think it's the same model. I wouldn't even know. You know, they run a little lighter of a program than you'll get at the state fair, you know, the traveling model. But it does the trick. It's still really extreme for in a park.
I did notice it took a little while to warm up, but it definitely got there. It got to that extreme spinning, you have no idea what the fuck is going on point.
Yeah.
It got there.
Every which way, and you're face planting, falling on your back, you're spinning, looping, everything. It's great.
Yeah. It was breaking down a bunch, though.
Yeah, it was.
Which is unfortunate.
I don't know what that's about, but hopefully it's just first year jitters.
Mm.
Hopefully the kinks will get worked out.
Or is that spot just cursed?
It took over the where Windseeker was.
Yeah.
In the park, next to the carousel. I mean, a nice addition, but honestly, that's a nice addition to any park.
Oh, yeah.
Any park that doesn't have a top scan could use one.
Timber Mountain Log Ride. We really kind of covered it.
Oh, we covered that.
On the Halloween episode.
Yeah.
Great. Looks great after major refurb. Calico Mine Ride. That was also semi-new for us because they did a major refurb on that.
Oh, yeah. That was nice.
And that looked great.
Yeah. They souped up a couple of those characters. I think it was good. I think like they left them still cheesy enough, but now... Good, but also good enough. Like it just worked. It was. I think they found the happy medium. I don't know if that's what they were going for, or they just didn't, you know, they just couldn't afford the best level of animatronic or not, but it was perfect for that application. You know, that ride shouldn't have like the quick moving universal animatronics. And I guess no one else outside of Disney has the smooth ones, the really super smooth ones. But this was like perfect.
Yeah.
Still this... a little like store mannequin-y, but better, much better than they used to be.
Right. Well, now it's the really charming older animatronics. Before it was just kind of like it was getting to be a little sad.
Yeah, a couple maybe were downright creepy.
Yeah, but now it's like the totally functioning, charming old animatronic look. Yeah. So that's nice.
Yeah, it was cool. A couple new effects for the finale. The glory hole. Still great.
Yeah. Oh, it is really impressive. It's such a gigantic set piece. Yeah. And the train just keeps circling it, too. They know it's so good they had to keep showing it off.
Yeah, at least, what, three different times?
Yeah, something like
that. You see it? You get a different window into it? Yeah, it's cool.
It's an impressive ride, still, I think.
Great stuff.
Coast Rider?
Oh, nah.
Was new for us?
That was nothing.
Mouse?
Well, actually, it wasn't nothing. You know what? Are we calling it? Worst mouse ever. I think we're calling it.
It's definitely the worst Mac mouse. Is it worse than the Revercon spinning mice?
Oh, you want to go spinning? Oh, I thought we were just going standard mouse.
Oh, just standard?
Out of standard mice, I think it rode the worst out of any I've ever ridden.
Yeah, I'll say
that. It was terrible. Worst restraints. Had some kind of awkward restraint system, and it was just... it's not good.
Yeah, where it really restricted your legs.
Yeah.
Apparently that was an addition that they had to add... I think in 2017, maybe. And it stinks.
Yeah, that wasn't very good.
And the rehabbed Ghost Rider.
With the new trains. New GCI trains, right? Millennium Flyers. And newly retracked by GCI.
Yeah,
right?
I believe
okay.
so.
All right, so... well, the sum total is I enjoyed it. It was a good ride. But the funny thing is... now it just feels like GCI made Ghost Rider's layout.
It kind of feels like that, yeah.
It feels exactly like what it is.
Yeah, it was a mixed bag. Parts of it were really good, but parts of it were not good or just slowed down too much at certain times. It was too herky jerky.
Well, that's the layout
experience. Yeah,
the layout has a couple of boring spots in it. But the action parts are all action and are really good.
Yeah.
So. It rode better now than it did 5 years ago.
Yeah, this was probably the best ride I ever had on it.
I don't know about that, though. I mean, it's been so many years now, but the first time we ever got to it, I think it may have still been better.
Yeah, all right.
Because it hadn't passed the tipping point in age where it was started to suck, but it was the original concept. You know, the original CCI concept, and I think it was still running very, very well.
Yeah, because the first time we did it, it was only 4 years old at that point.
Yeah.
All right.
And it was really running nice, and it's like, this is good, too. This is better than what it became in some of the in-between years, but it's different now. It's like a different ride, really. You know, it feels like a GCI ride now, which is not a bad thing, but it just doesn't feel like what it originally was either. So that's very good, though. It's a solid ride. That's about it. It's a solid ride. It's, you know, it's fun. Still play the fun cue video.
I still like that. And it still gets a major line.
Oh,
people love that ride out there.
They do.
Anything else concerning Knott's?
It's good. The park's no better or worse than it ever was.
Did not get to ride Accelerator. That was down.
It kind of breaks even these days. Accelerator was down. The Sky Cabin?
Oh, no, Mystery Lodge.
Mystery Lodge
did not get to do that.
Not showing that day we were there.
Yeah.
For some reason. I'm not really sure why.
Well, I know why.
Well, the park was, really
there
dead.
There was no one there. I've never seen Knott's like that before.
Or any California park, for that matter.
Yeah, any California park. Everything was a walk-on.
Yeah, that's true.
Actually, except for Ghost Rider. The only thing. That was because they were running one train, though. That was just
stupid. One train on Ghost Rider. That was bullshit. Yeah, I guess that's what we have to say. The operations blew.
Yeah, they did.
Knott's operations are just awful. And the big thing about that is that you're down the road from a place that has some of the best operations, probably the best operations,
yeah,
anywhere in Disneyland. So, like, how can you have such shitty operations?
Yeah.
Your direct competition, at least by location, does the greatest. And you just, oh, not even, like, okay operations or middle of the road. Just piss poor. Too many single train coasters. Silver Bullet was running one train, too.
Yeah.
So we got Silver Bullet and Ghost Rider, and they're both lengthy rides, too. And then the crews were not quick at unloading and loading that one train. Yeah, we ran into a lot of that.
Silver Bullet, I liked it the most I ever had this time.
Yeah, that's solid.
It's a solid ride.
I say
now.
Still, yeah. I think we weren't even doing this show. We weren't 5 years ago.
Yeah.
But we kind of liked Silver Bullet then, and then it's, yeah, that ride, it's okay. I came around on it.
Yeah.
I'm okay with it. It is kind of fun. You do feel like you're going upside down like 18 times. It like never ends. Like, it's constant inversions.
It hasn't moved in my standings of inverted coasters, but I do like it better now.
It just lacks a little bit of extra punch. It does all the inversions, but they're a little too graceful, almost, for its own good, in my opinion.
Yeah.
I can see a lot of people liking it like that way, but yeah, still, you know. For me, I want a little more grit. Anything else?
Right. Snots.
Is that it for the snot?
Let's blow this place.
All right.
Let's move on to SeaWorld San Diego.
Oh, do we have to?
Well, all right. We went there because it was included in the City Pass, right?
Yeah, Southern California City Pass. Oh, that's a good deal, by the way. I suggest that, recommend that to anyone doing a Southern California vacation, any enthusiast listening to this garbage. You must be an enthusiast. So, that Southern California City Pass is great. It used to be better, but it's still pretty good. You get a three-day hopper at Disneyland with that magic morning included, where you get in an hour early on at least one of the 3 days. And then you get SeaWorld and Legoland.
Yeah, we should actually go through that day, because we started at Legoland.
We did so we just kind of shoehorned those in there because they were included in the City Pass.
Yeah.
And we did Legoland and SeaWorld in one day.
So we go to Legoland in the morning, get there right at opening, and we got there for Ninjago, because we wanted to check out that dark ride.
Yeah, the only reason why we went. We've done it before otherwise.
Right.
And, you know, we're adults, and it's not really geared for adults, so that one time was good. But they did put something in that's supposedly innovative and new and kind of first of its kind, so we wanted to check it out, of course.
Right. Yeah, the thing is, it's like a dark ride shooter, but you don't use a gun, you use your hands somehow to shoot the targets on screen.
Yeah, so, sounds cool.
Yeah, we wanted to try that. Unfortunately, it was closed, so we didn't get to do it.
Yeah, the only reason we went there.
Yeah.
And it was closed, so...
So we gave it an hour. We were there for 1 hour, and it still wasn't opening.
We rode the dragon.
We did that for the hell of it. And they didn't say if it was going to open or not. They didn't know. So we left. And when we were leaving, the lady at the turnstile asked us...
This is great, yeah.
Oh,
Not even. It was like 45 minutes, I think.
45
maybe.
Minutes?
It was
sure.
Like 45 minutes after opening, yeah. And then, you know, the woman at the turnstile to stamp your hand. Of course. And of course she figured we must have just forgot something in the car, or maybe we're staying at the hotel.
Yeah.
And or maybe we forgot our kids. That's what she thought.
Yeah.
Why are three like 30 somethings in here by themselves? They must have forgot their kids and they're coming back for them. So it was something like, yeah, you're coming back, right? Or, you know, like, of course you're coming back, you know, that was sort of her attitude. You know, I think she did ask though, like, you know, you guys coming back in? Are you guys coming back in? And then, like, no. And then just, yeah, total shock on her face. Like, she couldn't have been more shocked.
Yeah.
Like, oh, my God, we failed.
I mean, it cost, like, $90-something to get in there.
Yeah, I know. Three people to go in for 45 minutes, and they're like, yeah, no, we're good.
Yeah.
I already know I don't like this place. I've seen enough. I can tell. It sucks. Right.
The look on her face was priceless. And it's like, and that's a big park. It's not possible to, like, like anything in 45 minutes in that place.
Yeah, you can get a couple rides in the morning, but yeah, you're not doing even 50% of it.
Yeah.
That was hilarious, yeah. And then we weren't going to stop and explain it to her.
Right.
We were just like, nah, you know, No. And she's just shocked. Couldn't believe it.
Well, because I don't know if we'd ever done that before.
No, that has to be the earliest we ever left the park. For good, for that day. I mean, we had the city pass. We didn't actually blow $100 just to do the dragon.
Right.
So it didn't really cost us anything extra. I guess parking.
Parking, that was the one thing.
But whatever. I mean, you know, we had to try Ninjago. It should have been open. It wasn't advertised to be closed.
And there were other people there waiting for it to open. We weren't the only ones.
Well, what are you going to do?
So anyway, blew that place and...
Blew it up!
Went to
SeaWorld. Blew the Legos up next, yes.
And we went over to SeaWorld San Diego.
What a mistake that was. No. And then why did we go there? We went there for the same reason we always go to any SeaWorld. For the rides.
Yeah.
We don't give a shit about the fish anyway.
So, we checked out Manta. Well, this was...
Oh, yeah.
This was some, not revenge, but...
It was a reckoning.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, we got screwed out of this ride 5 years ago, and it was time for us to finally get it.
Yeah, because we were there, they were testing the ride, they were testing it for a long time, but we had to catch a flight, and we just couldn't wait any longer.
Yeah.
So we didn't get it. But we sure rode the hell out of it this time.
Oh, yeah, never had to wait. We got, maybe 6 or 7?
Yeah.
Out of the day? We kept doing it. Well, all right, so we kind of just blew it there. I guess we liked it, if we did it that many times.
I really
times.
Liked it, yeah. I thought it was great, actually.
We tipped our hand. Yes, we liked it a lot. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, nice little Mac launch coaster, 2 launches on it, stays low to the ground, got some nice back-and-forth action on the turns.
Yeah, a little airtime.
Good speed, good Gs, yeah. Really nice, sort of more extreme family coaster.
It's one of those that you're done, you wish you had it in your backyard.
Yeah.
You know? Damn! Gotta get me one of these! It's just a lot of fun.
Yeah, I have been saying this for years. I want to see a full-scale Mack coaster, a big adult-sized Mack coaster in this country. I want someone to put one of these things in.
Well, this is adult-sized.
Well, I know,
it is not a junior by any stretch of the imagination.
Like, I want it to be 2, even 3 times as big as this, you know, with inversions and all that stuff. Yeah, because they do make them. Other parks not in this country have put them in. So I want to see this country do that because I think they do good work.
Yeah, great, smooth, well-designed. Really, you can't say much bad about it. Yeah. I mean, it really was solid.
Just lap bar, you know, no over the shoulder.
Yeah, comfortable. The effects tunnel thing that the park, I guess, is to blame for. That's just whatever. But,
yeah,
you know, we didn't even see the original concept because it was running the Halloween mode.
Yes.
Which was silly, but I can't imagine the original concept being much better. You just held up in a tunnel, just a tunnel screen. It's just a screen all around you.
Yeah.
For like, whatever, 30 seconds, and then you launch.
I like it better than Cheetah Hunt, for sure.
Oh, the ride now, okay, yeah, itself.
And I like it better than Verbolten, too. I would rather have this ride in Williamsburg than Verbolten. It's just more satisfying for me.
It's close, I don't know. I
can understand why you hesitate.
I know, and I know what I said that day. I'd rather have Manta in Bush Williamsburg than Invader.
Oh, that's right. Yes,
that's my switch. Now that would be kind of a little redundant to have Verbolten and Manta because they're very similar.
Yeah.
In what they do, but that I could say hands down, just because Invader didn't do it for me. And Invader is closer to an actual family ride. Manta is at that same level as Verbolten. It's a family ride, but at the very upper end of it.
Right.
It's extreme. It's still extreme. It still pulls some G's. The launch is pretty fast. It's good. But whatever it is where it is, it's in SeaWorld San Diego, so good for them to have one good ride.
Yeah. I mean, at least within the SeaWorlds that is in the proper SeaWorld park, it's good that the flyer, Manta...
He's
in Orlando, yeah.
Oh, well, yeah.
That would have been really bad if they had swapped those and they had mixed those up.
Yeah, even they weren't that dumb.
Yeah.
yeah, no, that's good. Because Orlando is the only one that's guaranteed to continue operating.
Yeah.
Push come to shove.
For the foreseeable future.
The next 10 years or so, I don't know. Other SeaWorld's a little on the edge.
Yeah.
It may not be around forever. That was a lot of fun and a good addition to that park. We did all the rides there, though.
We did.
Which we hadn't done before. We never did the rapids either.
Finally got those goddamn rapids in.
The shipwreck rapids. They're okay. I don't know.
Yeah.
Just okay. Nothing special.
It's a newer rapids.
Yeah, newer 99, I think.
Okay.
I listen to our rapids show. We go through all of them. Yeah, Intamin, turntable, classics stuff there. Just okay, though.
Just okay.
Not a great course.
Well, they walled off the waterfalls.
It was too much. Oh, yeah. They figured. We saw where the waterfalls, we used to probably be able to go into them, the raft, and then... Yeah, that was one of those where it was just kind of like... I mean, we know the original rapids, the first few years of rapids, the 80 and the 81 and 82 ones, where they had to wall sections off because at first Intamin was a little too overreaching. They kind of were going for a real river. But then the rafts, I think, would actually get stuck in spaces, and that would be an issue. So they had to kind of narrow the trough and make it more of a ride, really. It's not actually a real river. But, you know, you can't do it like that, exactly. And that, but even, like, in, like, the late 90s, they still were screwing up and, like, had a...
That's terrible.
Had to narrow the trough later on. Had to do, like, retrofits because they still were screwing up.
I can't believe that.
And that's, you know, that's just classic Intamin.
Yeah,
that's like, that's Intamin for you. They just can't get it right.
I know, they just never learn from their mistakes.
Yeah, they always just, I don't know, they go, you're always a little overreaching somewhere or just plain dumb somewhere else. They don't take the notes from the previous rides that they did and they just kind of make the same mistakes again. I don't know. Such a dumb company. But yet so vital.
Yes.
To the amusement industry. So it's like you can't really hate them.
They've created some amazing rides.
That's another show. That's a whole other show. We could do an Intamin show one day. But yeah.
They're complicated. Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, that's funny. Also, maybe people were getting too wet. I don't know.
Because we were pretty wet.
Like we were
right
enough.
Before we got to that part. Yeah.
With what the ride has as it is. Yeah. It's like, it is a reanimal life park, really, or at least was, or it's in the process of changing over now. But so it's like, do people really want to come there to get soaked?
Yeah, it's a good
maybe
question.
Too many people didn't want that, and then they kind of had to scale it back. So that could be too, while they walled some of the falls off. But it's fun. It's some fun theming. You go through the bottom of that ship,
yeah,
like the rusted out hull of a shipwreck. They did fuck one thing up though. The shipwrecked ship is right side up. But then there's a restaurant inside of it on the top level. The bottom level is like the rapids go through it, and the top level is an eatery, and then the eatery is designed such that everything's upside down, which is neat. I applaud them for creativity and getting that right, because it kind of works. They kind of got everything upside down, but yet why? Because the exterior of the building is right side up.
Yeah.
So they kind of messed that up.
That's a bad mistake. That's very strange.
I think they would have caught that before they built it, but okay.
What else?
So shipwreck.
Oh, we did the Skyride finally.
Did the Skyride. That was cool.
That was something. It was a little different.
Skyride almost 100% over water.
Yeah, it's pretty freaky.
Yeah, you don't like those kind of things to begin with as much as me.
I don't really like heights, but more than that, I don't like the water, and that's the part that really got to me on this one.
Yeah, it's one of those weird mindfuck kind of things. It's like, you're in the bucket, right? So you're not exposed. If the bucket somehow fell off the cable, the water probably would, you'd have a better chance of survival over the water.
I suppose. Would you?
Because you're not falling, like the bucket is, right? So then like the water will break the bucket fall better. I know like if just a human being falls, if it's high enough, it doesn't matter. Water or concrete, it's the same. When you start getting into really extreme heights.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, from lower heights, water does make a difference. But,
you're still breaking a leg or something, I think.
Oh, yeah, you're not going to come out unscathed, but I think you might actually have a better chance of survival with the water.
But the problem is, the bucket's going to sink, and there's no way to get out because you're locked in there, and you can't crawl out through the top of it.
Oh, that's creepy.
So you're just going to drown and die.
Oh, so you drown instead of the immediate death of hitting asphalt.
Yeah.
That's actually worse. Okay. You convinced me. I didn't think about the second hand, the second part of it.
Well, yeah, I didn't think about it until just now either.
Oh, that's creepy.
Because you can't get out.
They gotta close that shit. No, no, it doesn't happen.
But then, well, okay, I mean, the bucket falling off the cable is not really gonna happen. But what if it just gets stuck there and you can't bring it to one of the stations?
Do they have like a boat with a ladder?
Then it's like, yeah, what do they do?
They must, right?
I guess so. They've gotta. Like a boat with like a bucket lift on it or something?
That Skyride has been in operation for decades.
Yeah.
So they must have something. Yeah, I've just gotten stuck once or twice in like 40 years that it's been there.
I guess.
Or at least 30 to 40. Whatever. It's fine.
Well, we survived.
That was neat. We saw the old Atlantis restaurant.
Yeah.
The building.
Yes, we did.
The Skyride used to take you there. Now it's just a round trip.
What else did we do?
What is?
Wild Arctic was not open.
The ride was not running, no.
Yeah.
The pavilion was. We walked through the exhibit again, but we didn't get to go on the ride.
What else? What else we got here?
And then we did Journey.
Oh boy.
To Atlantis. Or just Atlantis.
Yes, just Atlantis.
If you want to go by the sign. Well, that just blows now. They just tore the heart out of that ride.
Oh god, it was so sad to see. Because
yeah.
It wasn't open at first, but they did get it up and running.
It opened late that day, yeah.
And they just tore all the theming out.
They gutted it.
And it's just pathetic.
It's a journey to a parking garage.
Yeah, that elevator lift.
It's like a parking garage elevator now.
They ripped out everything in there so you can see everything. Everything's exposed. You can just see going up.
Yeah. You pull into it. It's just like black and like beams. And at first,
and it pauses for.
It didn't register with me at first.
Yeah.
I was like, I guess this is what it was. I don't know. It's been many years since we've done it. It's been like 10 years, I think. Maybe more. 11? It's 2006, I think.
All right.
So at first, yeah. And then it's like they didn't change the program of the ride. So it still pauses, and like you were supposed to see some shit on some screens, I think, in front of you. I think. Always be some music or something. And now it's just nothing. So it just sits there for like a minute, and then it goes up. And then, yeah, and you can see straight out in front of you, and you just see like the beams and the concrete of the inner structure of just the building itself. And it's just like going up floors of a parking garage.
It's like uglier than that, though.
Cinder block walls. It's just...
Because it's like exposed mess of steel beams and rusted out shit. It's just awful.
Well, because it's not new either. Yeah, it's like going through a construction site even, maybe in that sense. Yeah, it's really strange. Like, why even operate it with that?
Yeah, just it looks so bad.
And then, it was always... It was the second one after Orlando, and it was always the step down with the theme. Because the coaster part was always bare bones anyway. So that actually doesn't really matter. But the part that was themed was the elevator lift, and that's gone. And that sucks. And then nothing else was working either.
No.
Where they used to be, like, whatever, there used to be water sprays and some parts. I think toward the end, they used to be the falling, whatever that is, piece of Atlantis. Right before the first drop, the water drop.
Okay.
That's dead. It just sits there now. It's just a straight up, whatever, the ride, the hardware.
And that does function fine, it's it's smooth and it goes through the whole course just fine.
It's a solid, like, shoot-the-shoots drop.
Yeah.
And then it's a solid, like, little coaster part. That's still fine, but it was so much more.
That's too bad.
It's sad.
Yeah. And then the new area.
Wait, what was it called?
Is it Ocean Explorer, or is that the ride? Yeah, I think Ocean Explorer is the area, and then Submarine Quest is that new dark ride, like elevated dark ride that's mostly outside.
That's not dark at all?
Yeah, there's a small indoor section.
I completely forgot about that.
Yeah, because it was closed.
It was
and
closed.
We didn't get to do it.
Did not
we
get to do it.
We had another ride that same day, brand
same
new.
Day. Yeah.
Brand new for that year, for 2017, not open.
I don't really give a shit, because it supposedly sucks.
Yeah, and they weren't even working on it. It was just flat out closed.
Do you want, we go to watch it right now? I have not. Have you ever?
No, I haven't.
You want to just YouTube it and just, what the fuck? That's it, huh?
Oh, that looks like total garbage. That looks like a total waste of money.
Yeah. Like, for them. I mean, it's just as good as riding it, I guess, there.
Sure.
I mean, it's like what you see outside is pretty much the whole thing.
Yeah.
Like, from off-ride, we saw the track. There's, like, that one scene with a squid.
Yeah.
And that was really cheap looking.
Whatever. And then they added a wave swinger.
Jellyfish swings, right?
Yeah, jellyfish swings.
Yeah, we actually did it.
Yeah, it's not really adding much to the park, but it's, yeah, it's not, whatever. I don't know. I really don't have much to say about it.
No, based on Knott's Berry Farm and also Legoland, those same 2 days of the week we talked about, the park was probably extra dead because of that, because people were working and the kids were at school, and so they're not at the park. But at the same time, that park, more than the other two, just felt like a dying park. Like a dying business. It did. It, yeah, just, you know, and maybe it's because we're being influenced by our knowledge of what we know is going on in actuality, where the SeaWorld parks are struggling. But yeah, it felt like this place is dying. And right, it felt very much like this is the last time we're ever going to be there. And it could be. It could easily be closed next time we go back to Southern California.
Really, it was not a good feeling.
Yeah, no, because that is such a massive park.
Oh, yeah, it's so big. All those SeaWorlds were just overbuilt.
Yeah, oversized at least, yeah. And,
yeah, oversized.
Just for that size and it's have so few people there, there were whole areas of Midway you'd be walking where you didn't see anybody else but us, yeah, but our group. Yeah. And then you'd see some people, you'd pass by, but yeah, just no one there. The place is just dead. We brought it up when we were there. It felt like Jaga Lake. When we were there in the 2007 season, late in that season too, which turned out to be the last season.
Yeah.
So it really was like the park was only open for maybe 6 or 8 more weeks after we were there, ever, and then closed. And I remember how dead that was, and it had that feeling.
Yeah.
And we didn't know for sure. It hadn't been announced that it was closing yet, but it felt like it. And I wasn't too surprised when we did hear about it. I don't think SeaWorld San Diego is that close to closing. But,
well, they're putting in a brand new ride for 2018.
Yeah, there was actually a construction site at the time.
Brand new coaster, so.
Yeah, but they're putting in a new ride, but it's nothing too big or complicated. Just a shelf.
No.
Another one of those. Skyrocket 2s. It was kind of sad to see. I'm sure it has days when it still gets pretty busy, though. All you hear is that it's getting worse every year. Every season. Hopefully they have time to turn them into full, all-out ride parks. But they're not doing great at that either, which we just talked about Journey to Atlantis. And the sad state that's in. Yeah. So it's not like they're really doing kick-ass. And then the new thing looks like shit. The Submarine Quest. So it's like not exactly like, you know, rocking the world with these new great themed attractions.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
it's a very mediocre experience, really. You know, and it always was for us because we never gave a shit about the fish anyway.
That's right, yeah.
So it's no loss for me. We didn't see any shows. You know, if they even were doing them, I don't even know. There was nobody there.
Yeah, they probably canceled them.
They may have. But we didn't even seek them out. We don't care. Yeah. We just rode Manda a shit ton of times and then did some rapids, did some Journey, Skyride, and then we did this tower.
You did the tower, yeah.
The observation tower, and that was fine.
Oh, and that one flat ride thing.
Oh, yeah, the other thing, the new, it's a Troika, I think.
Yeah,
or it's or some other manufacturer's spin on a Troika or something, but yeah, that was fine. Yeah, all right. SeaWorld San Diego. So we blew it up. We flooded that one out. We flooded it out. It's done. Moving on.
Six Flags Magic Mountain.
Oh no.
Yeah.
The park you have to go to every time you're in Southern California. It's a pain in the ass in every way. You got to drive a little bit to get there through that wonderful California traffic, and then at least Southern California, at least, and the place is in the middle of the desert, right? It's a mountain in the desert, so it's hot, and then it is a kind of a mountain, so the walking in the park sucks. The park itself is way too big for itself.
Oh yeah,
it's a monster, and then it has to be. The most poorly maintained of all the Six Flags parks.
I think it just might be, yeah. Because, oh boy, it just seems to be in really rough shape, the whole place.
There are sections, though, that really feel like a third world park.
Oh, yeah. The area, whatever it was, the former boardwalk area, wherever the hell it was, down by Apocalypse. Like, that stretch from Apocalypse to the go-karts. That is so bad. That looks like an abandoned theme park or a third world theme park.
Right. Yeah,
atrocious.
It's like, yeah, I've never actually snuck into a already closed park, nor have I been to like Egypt or some of those areas of the world where, you know, but I've seen plenty of pictures and YouTube videos of those experiences. And yeah, there's parts of Magic Mountain that look like that, which is really sad.
Yeah.
What is supposed to be like your flagship or a co-flagship park of what's got to be the most well-known amusement park chain in this country, household name, Six Flags. And like, this is how you treat it? Whole sections of it are just like left for dead and just rotting. Really weird and really sad. So that part of it kind of stinks. Like, it took a while for me to adjust, I know. I don't know about you, but like, it took maybe after like maybe 2 or 3 hours that we had been there, I finally just was able to put that out of my mind and kind of move on.
I don't know if I really ever pushed past it.
Because like, the first couple hours there, though, yeah, it was really kind of rough.
Especially coming from Disney. Did we do Disney the day before?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, so that was pretty jarring.
Just such rough shape, that place.
And we visit Great Adventure every season. It's not like, you know, and New England, and those are, you know, as rough as they can be, they look pretty damn great compared to Magic Mountain.
Yeah, Magic Mountain, like, makes Great Adventure look pretty great.
Yeah.
In comparison.
Well, it's like that park is just way too big for itself. You just can't keep up with the maintenance.
That is my theory. That's what I think. I think it's too large, and yeah, the budget just can't cover everything. They can't possibly buy like enough buckets of paint and enough new asphalt and pieces of lumber that they need every year to kind of keep things looking good. So they have to just take a corner of the park every year maybe to focus on or something. But other areas just get forgotten. And like, we just don't have the money, guys, in the budget. We got to let this go for a while. Yeah, that is kind of the fault of the original creators of that park, that they just made it way too large.
Yeah.
But besides that, okay, what was new? We're not doing a full park review right now, so.
Well, you want to do Full Throttle? Because that's the oldest new thing for us.
Okay. Yes.
And it's a... Yeah, I hadn't thought about it like this, but you pointed this out. This is sort of a Premier's custom Skyrocket 2.
Yeah.
Kind of like that. And that's a pretty good way to think about it, where you have, you know, launch out of the station. Premier loves that. No inversions, like almost inversions.
Well, no, there is. There's a loop.
Oh, that's right. Full Throttle. It's like the largest loop in the world or something.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. The ride sucked, so I
oh, no. Yeah. It in the end, it's like not as good as the shelf model.
The funny thing is that I actually was enjoying the ride up until the very end when they really fucked it up.
Yeah. Well, they decided to start the final brake run on the drop.
Yeah.
Like, on the last drop.
And it brakes hard.
Yeah.
It hurts.
Yeah, I guess it's less of an issue for those who white-knuckle it and hang on anyway.
Okay.
It's just a lap bar anyway, right?
Yeah.
There was no over-the-shoulders.
No comfort collar?
No comfort collar, okay. Which is nice. But, you know, for us, we just kind of, you know... We go hands up all the way. And in some cases, I'm as loose as I can be on rides. That's how I like it. You know, I like to ragdoll it. I want to be tossed around. It's great. I'm not worried about the restraint opening. It's fine. But yeah, when you did, we did it on this ride. Yeah, if you come to the end and the brakes, you're dropping. It's a nice vertical drop. It's the second. It's coming down off the top of the loop. That's actually the finale. You go up and coast over it and then down. You know, you're literally on top of the loop. You do the loop earlier in the ride, and then you're on top of it later. Look up pictures. That's all I can say. It's hard to explain. And then, yeah, like halfway down the drop, the brakes start, and hard brakes, like magnetic brakes. And it's like, whoa! Yeah. And I got a lap bar in the gut, and it felt like I got punched in the stomach. Hard. It sucked.
I think the best part of it, maybe, was that there's like one maneuver that looks impossible. You launch, I think you go into the loop, and then you go up and around like where the old, the old monorail station was?
You go into the old monorail station.
You go into it, yeah.
The tunnel
and,
one.
And yeah, the turn into that is like impossibly tight, but it that was kind of neat. And then you launch again, but it's sort of like the Skyrocket 2, yeah, where you go back
and then forward again,
and it's just a mess. It's a herky-jerky mess.
That's kind of neat to do just in the middle of a full-course ride.
It's interesting.
Instead of it being like the opening out of the station, like it is in the Skyrocket
2. Okay, yeah, all right.
And that just looks like a weird, you know, and it is. It functions essentially like a flat ride. And it kind of looks like it. It looks like a weird creation, a mad scientist, a RCT thing. This is like a regular roller coaster. Then to have in the middle all of a sudden have a forward backward part is kind of it's kind of neat.
Somebody had to do it.
But in the end, it's like better on paper. It doesn't really matter when you're doing it. It's not that great.
Yeah. But in the end, yeah, it was just not as satisfying as that little Skyrocket 2.
The proof of concept was better than the custom layout.
All right. The other new coaster for us, Twisted Colossus.
It's like night and day.
Yeah.
With Full Throttle.
Yeah.
We had our, what I think may have been my least favorite of the new things we did on...
out of everything.
On this. I mean, you know, because the... we didn't get to do. I mean, Submarine Quest probably would have been my least favorite, but we didn't get it. You know, writing it on YouTube weeks later doesn't count. So,
well, give or take, Coast Rider at Knott's.
Oh, yeah, all right. I'll still take Full Throttle over Coast Rider. Okay, forgot about Coast Rider. But I think what may have otherwise been my most favorite new for this vacation. Adventure thing. Attraction. Twisted Colossus. Wow.
Yeah, they did something crazy. They combined two coaster layouts into one.
Well, two separate roller coasters.
Yeah, they just made it one long
track.
Because
that is what, you know, dual roller coasters, essentially it's two separate roller coasters. Two separate credits, if you ask me.
Mm-hmm.
That's always highly debatable in the roller coaster community. But
yeah.
It doesn't, because you can separate them.
Oh, yeah.
And then it's like, and then it becomes two then, but it wasn't two before.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, I digress.
Well, you know, they replaced the old original Colossus, which was not very good.
No.
Massive wooden coaster.
Massive piece of wooden garbage.
Racing wooden coaster, yeah. And now they have a racing dueling steel coaster with, you know, talk about impossible maneuvers. I don't know how the hell Rocky Mountain does it, but they just come up with the craziest shit. Just looking at it, I don't know. I don't even know how to describe it because it's just it shouldn't work.
So this is another Rocky Mountain job. That's what it is. Yeah, it took Woody made it a steel ride. They took two separate roller coasters and made them into one. So now it's all one ride. You ride both sides in one shot. I don't know who came up with that, but what a great idea is all I have to say. I mean, yeah. I probably would have been satisfied if it was two separate and you had to wait twice. Because they're great. Each half is great on its own. But just to combine it into one and just get it all over with in one shot, that's like the icing on the cake.
I guess they thought that just one half of it was not quite long enough.
It would be a little short if it was only half.
Yeah, that's the only thing I could it would come be. Up with.
Instead, now it's like almost overly long.
But now it's really long.
It's, you know. But,
well, because, yeah, you have that giant lift hill.
So
you have to do twice.
You're on it for a long time, yeah. But it's great. I mean, it's almost like it can't be too long, I don't think.
Yeah.
Most roller coasters gets to like be like 8-10 minutes. I mean, yeah, you can give me a good 5. I'm good.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, maybe with the average person, it gets to be too much. But for me, I don't know. I could do more.
And they did figure it out, by the way, to have the trains duel and race, where the lift will slow down.
Oh yeah, it
for
definitely
one of the trains
has
to catch
like
up.
A computer system that's monitoring the situation. I guess it's
yeah,
kind of monitors it. It does something where yeah, the train slows down as much as it can. There is a tipping point though,
yes,
where if they don't get the train out fast enough, the one that's already been dispatched will eventually just go into the ride.
Yeah, it doesn't come to a stop ever, but it slows down as much as it can. And then after a while, yeah, it just says, screw it, we're going. We can't wait any longer.
Yeah.
Which is, yeah, that makes sense. That's good that they did that. But yeah, but wow, what a ride. Incredible. I think this is the best coaster in the park now. And this is my favorite.
Wow.
This is my favorite.
That far.
Yeah, this is my favorite Rocky Mountain too. This ride is just
I think it is
incredible.
I think it is the best thing Rocky Mountain's ever done.
Yeah.
This is it.
It's just every single moment on that ride delivers.
The second
There's
you come
not
off the
a
lift.
Dull yeah. Second.
You come off that lift. It's got the little slightly curve in the curve drop, like a little curve too, which I don't remember Colossus had. I thought the Colossus drops were straight, but maybe they weren't.
Yeah, I don't know actually.
Supposedly these always kind of follow the original profile more or less.
Sort of,
these do. I mean, the structure is obviously still there, so I guess Colossus had a little turn to the drops, kind of like that old cyclone trick.
I guess.
Brooklyn Cyclone. That's been copied so many times. But now it's so pronounced with the Rocky Mountain track on top, you know. So they have a little curve to them that you don't expect right away, and then, you know, and down, and that's it. It's just like chaos.
Yes.
But it's great chaos. It's just, it's beautiful chaos. It's everything just works, and it's just nothing but impossible turns and banks, and there's nary a straight piece of track on that thing.
Oh, yeah.
The rails are constantly bending and contorting.
And they did do the, whatever it's called, you know, like you're riding on the underside of an arch kind of a thing, like the maneuver they
do on... Hammerhead stall?
Wherever they call it. Yeah, the same kind of thing they do on Goliath at Six Flags Great
America.
They
did one of those.
And that's so great.
But that's one of the interactive moments.
Yeah.
Now, because the other train's like below you.
Yeah.
So it's like one riding right side up, one upside down.
Yeah, I do have to say, the other train being there, because we did experience it with the way it's supposed to be, where we do race and duel, but we did have one half, the second half, one time where it was just us, because the other train couldn't get out in time.
But we got it both ways.
And I don't think it matters, really, if the train is there or not. The ride is insane no matter what.
The dueling moments, I guess, they're not really... They didn't advertise it, right? Like that. I didn't really see that anywhere.
I thought they did.
Oh, they did? Oh,
they
did.
Matter.
I think they're calling them something else. High five moments or something like that.
Oh, maybe that's what
yeah.
it is.
Yeah. Okay. It's not... They're not calling it like a racing dueling
moments
like other manufacturers or parks have done in the past.
That's a Rocky Mountain thing. They don't call... Even though an element may be the same as another manufacturer's element, they don't call it the same thing.
Yeah, they're big on like creating their own terms.
Yeah.
Those high five moments that they're calling them, dueling moments, they are a lot of fun. They're cool. But yeah, you don't need them. The ride is good enough by itself. The elements are crazy enough by themselves that it's like you don't need them either. It's like if the other train's not there, you don't miss anything either. It's like it's still an awesome ride.
And I'll say I think I like the first half just a titch better than the second.
It's all so insane. But I don't know.
Right, that's the thing, though. It's not like, you know, even if the drop-off is ever so slight, it doesn't make a difference because you're starting from such a crazy place.
Yeah, I think the first half has the hammerhead stall.
Maybe that's why I
think. And that may be still like a shining moment in the ride, maybe the best moment. So maybe that's that. But, I mean, it's such an awesome experience.
Yeah,
what a ride.
Just, when the whole thing is over, when each half is over... Just
even when
losing your mind.
Yeah, when you have that chance
to
ponder what you've just done when you're on the lift the second time. The second lift.
And right, it's like, we're doing this again?
And it's just like, whoa, holy shit. That ride.
Right, yeah, you're on the lift the second time. You're in disbelief.
Your mind's already blown.
I'm going to do it again?
Yeah, so it's just like, what the fuck? There's another half of this?
Right.
Could it get any better? And then the second half does deliver. I mean, maybe if it is a little hair not as intense, but it still delivers. It's still great.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, God. What a ride.
Yeah, it's best coaster in California? Maybe.
It's so insane.
Yeah.
It's one of the best rides ever made.
It is. Yeah, it is.
It kind of is. It's just... I mean, boy, did they ever take a turd and turn it into some fucking gold.
Yeah.
Because they did.
Right, this ride is not to be missed now. Before, it was a total skip.
No, Colossus was garbage.
Yeah, you didn't have to do it if you went there. But this is, if anything, you have to do this ride when you go to Magic Mountain now.
Oh, yeah, Twisted Colossus. Incredible.
All right, so the only other, or the last new thing for us, was Justice League. And with this one, it was supposed to be a little different. And it was.
It was delivered.
From the very beginning, when you walk in there, instead of just waiting... in a regular queue indoors like all the other ones. This one, I guess, because they're pretty close to Disney and Universal, they wanted to make it feel like a bigger experience. So there are, is it two or three pre-shows? How many were there?
Yeah. As if pre-show equals big experience.
Yeah.
But they thought it did. At least two. And then there's a third part of the wait, that what I'm thinking of.
It's still two too many, though.
Oh, yeah. Because it's not very good. What they did was, they didn't do anything new, though. They didn't cut any new material. It's just the same cue video from the other Justice Leagues that are out there so far. And then they just cut it up, edited it a little differently to make this what's supposed to now be a pre-show. But it's okay as just sort of background noise, where you can watch for a little bit, then you could talk to the people next to you, then you can kind of go back and forth, it's just kind of on a loop in the queue, But as soon as it becomes like you're supposed to stop, be quiet, lights go down, let's just watch this, it's so dry.
Yeah.
And it's just not, it's not paced well. It's just, oh.
It is kind of amazing how that Q video and the other ones is fun. But then, yeah, when you're forced to sit down or where it's just stand
just
there and watch
stand
it.
Stand in one spot and watch it. Stop and listen.
It, yeah, it suddenly becomes not fun at all. It really sucks the fun out.
No, it's worse for us because we had seen it already, too, a bunch of times.
Yeah.
So that made it even worse.
Yeah.
But even for a newbie, like, the first time through is, I guess, okay, but then after that, it's got to wear on you. And then you get the animatronic one. You get the pre-show with the cyborg. That, I guess, I can kind of see because it showcases it more instead of just having it be there before you're bored. But at the same time, I just want to get on the ride. I don't want to have to do that every time. So, like, if that was my home park, I'd be kind of pissed. They made Justice League that much less rewritable.
The ride itself, though, so what was different exactly then?
They amped it up. Right? Yeah, they amped it up. It's funny, the actual loading station was like toned down because they used up a lot of that crap in the second pre-show.
Well, they used up everything. There was no giant screen or anything.
Yeah, so it was a smaller and like...
That was just a room with
dressed down
nothing.
Kind of loading station. So that actually seemed like a downgrade.
Yeah.
Compared to the other Justice Leagues we've done. But the ride was upgraded.
Mm.
They added a few more animatronics on the ride itself. This is spoilers, but whatever. They actually... The other ones only have one. It's just Joker. Now they have that, but they also have two or three of the orange jumpsuited goons in animatronic form shooting at you.
Yeah, with machine guns shooting at you.
Machine guns shooting at you. It's edgy. It's all... That's during the... Like, the drums on a shelf drop scene, too. So they totally amp that whole scene up. Instead of just being that the shelf tilting in on you and the drums drop and make loud bangs, now it's like that happens while you're being shot at with animatronics. There's a lot more going on. I think they added, maybe it wasn't animatronics, but it was a more detailed screen to the truck.
Yeah.
That almost hits you.
Did something with that, yeah.
Where now there's like guys in there also shooting at you. I think it's just a guy on a screen in the truck on the other versions, but that's it. Or maybe not even.
I think it's just a mannequin.
It's just lights and are just a mannequin, maybe?
I think it might be.
Okay, but now there's screens, and you can shoot them, too.
That's right!
You can shoot them.
Yeah, you can.
There's more stuff you can shoot, too, on this ride, yeah. Like, they amped that up. They actually did some physical Lex bots. Instead of it just being, like, the mist screen, that is cool on the other versions.
Oh, okay.
You can shoot.
Yeah,
one, there's actual Lex bots.
Mm.
That I think had some slight movement. They come down at you a little bit on the ceiling, and then you can shoot those. And then the very finale is Harley Quinn animatronic shoots you. She shoots the gas at you, the green gas.
Yeah,
that's the final gag. Like, you actually do die in the end, I guess. But they all do that. The Joker gets us with the gas in the other versions from the screen too. So they all have like the Joker's last laugh. We don't make it.
I thought that Harley Quinn animatronic was kind of wasted though. Because it's not even like it's the very end of the ride. It's really like you're waiting to get back into the station.
It's
like the ride's over,
it's
really.
It's the stack-up point, yeah, where the vehicles get stacked up.
I was like, why? She should be in there shooting at you, and I thought that was kind of a waste.
It's a little whatever. But, yeah, a little extra piece of fun they wanted to throw at you, I guess.
Yeah.
So they definitely spent a little more money and a little more time on this one, and they kind of amped it up a little bit, most likely because they thought it was... They're close to Universal and Disney, and so that's their competition, and they need to do something better. You know, they didn't feel that pressure in New Jersey.
Yeah.
Or St. Louis.
It's nice that that park has a dark ride.
Oh, it's something different. Welcome at that park, for sure. Something that's not a coaster.
Yeah.
Imagine that.
We'll see how long that lasts.
Yeah, exactly.
One last quick thing. It was nice to ride Revolution with just the lap bar and without that baby over-the-shoulder restraint.
Oh, yeah.
I don't get to experience that the way it was meant to be.
I imagine it was like opening day. I wasn't there, but I imagine it's just as good now as it was then.
Yeah, so that was cool. And I think that's
it. And no VR. We did not do the VR.
No.
We didn't bother that shit.
Anything else?
That's it for the mountain, I think.
All right. All right, now Universal Studios Hollywood. This was pretty different from the last time we were there.
Oh, yeah.
The whole upper lot has totally changed.
Yeah, many parts of it are unrecognizable from what they used to be.
Oh, yeah. When we first walked in there, I was so confused. I felt completely lost.
Thought you were in the wrong park, didn't you?
Yeah. Well, I guess what they're doing now is, and I don't know if I would have come to this conclusion or how long it would have taken me to come to this, but you pointed out to me right away, oh, they're just building a midway now, a proper midway is what they're doing.
Oh, yeah, entry midway.
Yeah. So they actually have like a straight stretcher walkway with stores and shops and stuff on either side of you instead of, I don't know, it was more maze-like before, with different alleys, I think.
Almost from the time you walked in, yeah. Because they had that walkthrough attraction that kind of came up right away on the left. And then, yeah, the gift shops were just kind of strewn around those early areas right after you got in the gate in the upper lot. But it wasn't like a true, concise, this is our entry midway. And they've done that finally. Yeah, they moved the entrance to the walkthrough to around the corner. And then, so it's not like it's an attraction right there. You know, it did feel like, it is. The park itself actually does have history that goes back to, what, the 60s or something when they made the upper lot. I'm not going to look into the exact date, but they started that upper lot, like, you know, a long time ago. Not right at the very beginning, but a long time ago. And, you know, it did have an old park feel, you know, like a Kennywood or something. You kind of walk in and attractions just start right away, along with shops and things, and just everything was just kind of mishmashed. And so they're trying to bring it up to the more modern theme park standards and have that midway that makes sense. It doesn't really work, though, because there's still a cutoff. Like, I think it's supposed to all lead to that, what's now that Universal Plaza, but it doesn't exactly lead to that. You still have to veer off a little bit to the left to get to that plaza, and there's a street before that you could cut off and never even get to the plaza. So it still doesn't exactly work. I mean, they weren't willing to, I guess, demolish everything and start from scratch. So they did the best they could with what they had. It's fine. I thought it was fine before, too. I don't really care.
Yeah, what they built looks nice. But that Universal Plaza just seemed, it's very large. It seems like kind of a waste of space. I'm not sure.
Yeah, for a park that's tight on space to begin with.
Yeah, I don't know why they left such a giant pad in the middle there. Of just nothing, just flat, nothing.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's event space, I think, is what it is. Like, they have events that come in, they'll throw a stage up and have an act play or something occasionally, I guess. But
all right.
But Orlando has that permanent stage and then a fake lawn, that event space. They like doing that.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know why. Right. They like doing that.
Okay.
I guess they have a lot of events. Well, that's when they have park buyouts and corporations come in. They want to have a space that's free.
Yeah.
I guess. Yeah. Yeah, that was weird. The park itself looked very different, and it took a while for us to kind of get our bearings.
Well, it was like I was there for the first time.
Yeah, just so many new structures.
That beginning area. Or really, just the whole upper lot. It was like I was there for the first time, almost.
Almost, yeah.
Because
almost no area was untouched.
Yeah, that whole entry area, and then right beyond it is Springfield now. That's totally new from when we were there last 5 years ago. They changed that area over by T2, and now that's all Despicable Me, and and they added Harry Potter, and yeah, it's really different. And I guess that International Street kind of area, that's like the only part that hasn't changed from five years ago.
That's still pretty much the same, but actually what's funny is now it gets people. That was like a dead zone before, because there wasn't much going on over there, but they added that super silly fun land into that corner, and now that brings people over there.
All right, so Harry Potter, Hogsmeade?
Well, I mean...
it's the same shit.
There's not much... I mean, listen to our, what's new in Florida over the last 5 years from last year, and you'll hear our comments on at least the Springfield. And then, I guess, we ever talked about Did we talk about Hogsmeade?
No, not really, because that opened before we
started
this
whole thing. Yeah, we weren't doing this. But the Hogsmeade is exactly the same as Orlando.
Yeah, pretty much.
I mean, they did it. They built it again off the same blueprints. I mean, they did it. Yeah, it's the same. It's just like doing dragons, which it's actually not missing anymore.
Yes.
It's missing it in my mind, but like they built that wall and everything too, and then it's like this is where the entrance would be, and then it's just not there.
Oh, you know what's funny though? Flight of the Hippogriff? Because I looked this up when we got home.
Oh.
So the one in Islands of Adventure, originally Flying Unicorn.
Right.
A Vekoma family coaster. But the one in Hollywood, that Flight of the Hippogriff, and it's supposed to be the same ride. It's actually a Mac.
Oh.
Pretty weird.
Is it the same layout?
I thought it was. I'm not totally sure.
It's very similar.
But it's almost like, it might as well be the same. I mean,
it's close enough, yeah. It's just some turns. I mean, and they're like equally fine.
Yeah, they're fun.
They're both fun. We did do that. Yeah, we got on that.
And the Harry Potter Forbidden Journey, fun. I feel like it's not okay. It wasn't done quite as well.
Yeah, it did seem like it was like the B version.
Yeah, and I have a theory on that. There wasn't as much movement. It was a little gentler, and I think that was because, again, I don't really know this. I'm just guessing here. Originally, this version was in 3D, but they have since removed that because people were getting too dizzy and getting sick and all this
Harry
stuff.
Harry Puker.
Yeah.
We did this.
and I think when they took the 3D away, well, I think they had to tone down the ride so people wouldn't get sick, but I guess it just didn't work and they scrapped the 3D altogether. But I don't think they adjusted the ride program. So it's
back to
tamer.
What it was originally. Yeah.
So I think it's tamer than
that's possible.
The Orlando one.
Yeah, it just didn't feel as crisp. There was like a few moments that were a couple of transitions that didn't seem as good to me.
Yeah, I just wasn't really that into it this time.
Maybe it was just a mindset thing for us, though. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I'll admit that. It could be.
Yeah.
They were loading it like shit.
Yes,
tell you
they
that.
Were.
They couldn't even fill all the seats because, like, they were too slow to get people on. I don't know what was going on there.
For us, we did single rider. For us single rider people, I don't know why they did this. They took us, like, backstage for a moment.
Yeah.
To bring us over to a different area of the loading platform. And that was very strange and, like, it takes you right out of it.
We walked through, like, the lunchroom or, like, the yeah. The area where the employees clock in or something. And then like, back into the loading area. And then
yeah. Because you're going from, like, a, you know, theatrically dimly lit themed queue area to bright light cinder block backstage.
Yeah.
No theme.
But all white.
Yeah.
It's, like, all white.
Such a contrast.
And then back into the theme. That was weird. They added like little roofs, though, right? Little coverage to
they
the top.
They did, yeah.
Of this one, these flying benches, I noticed that right away.
Mm.
I guess that's just because you see a little bit too much in the Orlando version out the top when they lean you back really. They do lean you back really far, a couple of times on the ride. So they tried to fix that with the little hood or so, something like that on the top of you.
Mm. Yeah, no mist screen in this version. I think they just have another whatever it is, Death Eater, whatever those things are.
Instead of the mist screen?
I think so. Oh, no picture on this.
They didn't take our picture, that's right, and show it later. What else would you see on the mist screen? Is that what you see in the mist screen?
I think it's supposed to be your car projected on there.
Ourselves, yeah, so they got eliminated that.
Yeah, effect. But then you can also, of course, buy the photo later in the gift shop.
Yeah.
But then they don't have that here for whatever reason.
Otherwise, same ride.
Yeah, same ride.
It's Forbidden Journey.
All right, so then Springfield?
Yeah, it was the same as Orlando.
Well, no, they did it differently.
The actual like mechanics or you know the way they had to design it.
Yeah, the layout of the land is different.
They have a lot less space, so they had to kind of build it on top of itself. It's
yeah. It was on one hand, it was kind of cool because they included more stuff from the show, more buildings, more things you would recognize. But at the same time, it didn't really make sense because every building then looked like a two-story building or the two things that were stacked were completely different. You know, it'd be like Moe's, but then on top of it would be like the prison or something.
It's all the,
and it didn't make any sense.
It's all the food destinations on
okay,
the lower
yeah.
level because you had to be able to walk into each one.
Yeah.
But then on the upper level was like the prison, the Springfield school.
Yeah, the nuclear power plant.
The nuclear plant, and then which aren't represented at all in Orlando.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's like it's kind of neat to have it. I see what you're saying. But at the same time, it's like, why is it, you know, either on top of or it's supposed to be like in the distance, a perspective thing right behind Moe's? Because that's not actually how it would be. So it's good and bad.
And they do the power plant's supposed to have like a meltdown every so often. So I guess they added some other interactive things to make the land a little more alive.
Little
I guess.
Touches.
Florida
doesn't
have
little
that.
Effects. Yeah, and then inside too is you know they had that second floor where you actually could eat.
Yes. Well, here, the inside of all of the eateries was much better than Florida. It was actually themed up. Each location, like Cletus's Chicken Shack was themed to that, the Krusty Burger was themed to that, and et cetera.
It had its own separate space.
And even the upstairs portions where you could eat were themed, too, to that specific eatery. So that was really cool.
Yeah, that was cool.
So they did that right the second time around.
It was a little too much of a retrofit in Florida with that international food court that was already there.
Mm.
And they didn't do enough with it. Moe's is the only one that got the treatment.
Oh, right.
Of its own interior. The other ones did not. So that is an improvement.
And it's better than what was there before. Whatever that was, like the Flintstones lame game or something.
It was like a Flintstones lame game midway. Yeah.
Yeah, that was pretty
just
bad.
Some lame games themed to Flintstones.
Like the live action Flintstones movie from the 90s.
Starring Rick Moranis.
Yeah. So this
and
is better.
John Goodman, right?
And John Goodman.
I almost said John Candy, but I realize that's not right.
John Goodman. Rosie Sorry, O'Donnell.
John Goodman. Oh, Rosie O'Donnell.
And I forget who plays Wilma. Oh, and Kyle MacLachlan is the bad guy.
Oh.
And Halle Berry is the number two bad guy.
Oh, man. Got her for
what
that?
A cast.
Oh, weird.
So, we got to experience the effect show.
Oh, that was neat.
That they have there now. I thought it was new, but you said it's actually been there a couple of years.
Oh, yeah. It was actually there 5 years ago when we were there.
Okay.
And we just didn't do it.
I didn't remember that at all.
We enjoyed it, right? I know you were just kind of like blown away by the fact that they were still doing it at all.
Yeah.
Like, it was really kind of felt like a callback to the past.
Oh, definitely. Well, it's amazing that Florida still has their effect show going after all these years.
Well, they have the makeup show.
And yeah, the horror makeup show.
Specific makeup.
Well, okay,
it's
sure.
One element of effects, but they don't have a general effects show, actually.
It's neat because, parks don't do this kind of thing anymore. You know, a behind-the-scenes look at how movies are made, kids. Because everyone can just... Well, first of all, everything's done on computers these days, so it's not like there's a lot of mystery there. But even still, you know, anyone can just look up how any of their favorite movies are made online with YouTube and all this stuff. So it's interesting that they still have this. And you know, it's not the best show, but I guess it's nostalgic. Maybe that's what it is more than anything for me.
Yeah, did it remind you of, like, 96, like, going to Florida for the first time and...
Yeah, I guess so.
Seeing some of that stuff the first time, you know, it's...
Yeah, between going to Universal Studios Florida and MGM.
And MGM, right? It's old MGM.
So, you know,
that was my first encounter with a movie park.
Yeah, yeah. You know,
before I went to Universal. And, yeah, it reminded me of, you know, Monster Sound, which I remember I saw that time. And the original backstage tour that park had.
Oh, jeez. That thing was a beast.
Yeah.
Did you experience the full blown version?
They
changed it like immediately after they opened.
I went
right?
to the park. It was 92, so it was two seasons in. It opened in 89, right?
Yeah, 89. Didn't it change like five times?
So it already changed at least once. I saw at least version two, maybe three.
Yeah.
I know there was a ton of versions, but I don't know where they were at that point.
Yeah, that's incredible how much they tweaked that.
They never left it alone. Essentially,
it's like
constantly
yeah.
tweaked it.
Yeah, if you're interested in that, look that up. That's, I guess if you're listening to the show, you're into parks and stuff. So it's pretty interesting.
Oh, yeah.
All the changes to that.
They kept changing
the MGM studio tour.
It's on now, it's gone.
Whatever it's called, Backlot Tour. I don't know what the hell it was called originally.
Yeah, Inside the Magic at one point it was called.
Yeah.
So it's a throwback to those, and it's neat. So it's like for 20, 25 minutes or so, you're kind of in that world again. It's like the early 90s all over again. So that's kind of fun. Yeah,
yeah.
I enjoyed it. I didn't have a problem with it. It's like, I it's not a must-do going back to the park, though.
No.
Like, I'm
no.
kind of good. Like,
yeah.
But, you know, whatever.
They actually do light someone on fire indoors, which I couldn't believe.
It's like they knew they needed some kind of punch.
Yeah.
They needed something to really, like, make the show worthwhile to people. Yeah. And they threw that in there.
And I think he's on fire, I think it was like 17 seconds or something.
That's long.
It was a while, yeah.
It feels long when you're watching them too, yeah.
And they also, and they always, you know, they have a lot of humor in these shows.
Yeah, the actual finale is like is the comedy routine.
Yeah, yeah.
So they end on the comedy note, the comic note. They have the fire thing before that. But yeah, they do a little bit of everything. It's cool.
All right. What else? Oh, Studio Tour.
What about it?
Well, they added Fast and the Furious since the last time we were there.
Boy, did they have... Well, no, that's not true. They just changed it. There was always a Fast and the Furious part.
Oh, that you're right.
I mean, not always, but there's been a Fast and the Furious part for, like, at least 10 years.
Yeah, there was the period where they had the one that was based on Part 3, Tokyo Drift, where the cars on robot arms would come at you and spin around and...
And do a dance.
It was...
It was terrible.
It was universally despised, and it really was bad. So that's gone now. It's funny, you drive past it, they didn't like demolish that.
You see the outside, yeah.
Yeah.
The gates that you would like drive through. Well, it seems like they don't demolish anything with that tour.
The bridge
is still there.
Yes.
We drove past that too. I don't know about the parting of the Red Seas. They may have demolished that. I don't know.
Yeah.
Or you just don't drive by it.
So, Fast and Furious.
That's the one new section. Well, I mean, the thing about this is it's supposed to be a preview, essentially, of what Orlando's getting, and it's in a more full form, standalone form.
Yeah. They like doing this. They did it with Kong. Now they're doing it with Fast and Furious.
Well, based on this preview, I am officially no longer excited whatsoever for Orlando's Fast and the Furious attraction.
And I'm with you on that one. Oh boy, was this disappointing. I mean, hold on a second.
I didn't have too much of a preconceived notion that it was going to be great.
Yeah.
Well, this is the difference between us here. I don't like this series.
Yeah.
I've never bothered to watch more than like 10 minutes of one of these movies. I kind of don't like this genre. I just am turned off by it.
Fast cars genre?
Well, car movie. Yeah, I'm not really into car movies.
Actually, I mean, that is, you could have a subgenre of like fast car movies.
Yeah, because I like action films, like, you know that.
Yeah, yeah.
But like, it's like, yeah, I don't really care for car films. I certainly don't care for Vin Diesel. I think he's awful. And then like, what it's become to like hastily put together sequels that just are shit. Like, I don't like that kind of thing. Like, if I'm going to do that, I'll do James Bond, because that's like the original. They originated the idea of like, let's just keep putting sequels together and never have it end. So like, all right, they started that. So, okay, fine. But when other people try to get on that, like years later, it's like, oh, come on, guys, stop it.
I am a fan of the series.
Yeah. So anyway, that's where we're different. You are a fan of the series.
I don't like every film. I like.
Okay.
I think the first one's good. The second one's total shit. Third one is kind of fun.
So it's bad, like, from the second one. That's weird.
The fourth one, I don't really care for very much. Five and six are the two best by far.
So I got better later, okay.
And then seven is not very good, and eight is total shit.
So it's on a downswing.
Oh, yeah.
So nine's will be great, right?
We'll see.
They're due for a good one.
The thing about the series is it just kind of defies logic. You would never have thought that this series would be as popular as it is and spawn as many sequels as it has. You know, going back to like 2001 when the first one came out, it's like you never would have thought that this series was going to go anywhere. Mm. So it's just amazing that it has.
You know, it's weird, especially now with this. There's so many of these big popular shows. I would have thought that it would have went into that realm.
Oh, sure.
And just become a show.
It could, yeah.
It still could, actually. Even after eight films, it still could.
Yeah, who knows?
But I would have thought after like just one or two films, and then it would have became a show.
All right, but anyway, so that's our background in Fast and the Furious. And the ride,
it's not...
I didn't have the highest hopes for this version of it, but after seeing sort of just how copycat it is, you know, compared to Kong, how much... It's just like the same goddamn
thing. It's just Kong. Yeah, it's the same thing. It's just the screen tunnel.
That's what was really disappointing, and it was such a disheartening thing to see. That now, yeah, I am not looking forward to the Orlando one.
Because it's like,
why do you need to have a version of that ride in each of your Florida parks? It doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah, they're doing that too much now, the double up.
You're going to get on board a truck and it's just a big screen tunnel is like the main, is the meat of the ride. And,
yeah, because it's not any better.
It's all right, but,
you know, watching Kong and the dinosaurs and then now you're just watching Cars.
But
it's actually kind of worse.
But
actually,
this is worse. I was gonna say, yeah, this. I was not enjoying the Fast and Furious section of this studio tour at all. It was a chore to get through, even though it only lasted whatever, like 2 minutes. That was a chore to get through.
Yeah, it's actually
because it was such bad CG, and you're like flying through. You're doing like the dumbest moves. It just, ugh.
Yeah, it's impossible. Yeah,
that's not in keeping with the series. It is, but it's like the dumbest parts of that series.
It's just
like the dumbest movies do, like, you know, the big impossible aerial moves, and the better ones do less of it. They still do it, but less of it.
Yeah. Yeah, all action movies defy reality to certain extents. I mean, I guess the ride defies a good attraction. The law of good attractions is what it does. You don't need the second Kong to begin with, and then this theme doesn't lend itself as well to that style.
Which is weird. I wouldn't have thought that.
It's just, it doesn't make any sense why you're in a big lug of a vehicle and you're in the middle of all the fast-moving cars. And
right, you're keeping up with, like, souped-up sports cars and shit.
Yeah, what? And then it's all crap. And then this also needs to have humans in the CGI, which is also problematic. At least Kong, it could just be all CGI and you could just accept it because it's mythical creatures, more or less. I mean, you know, Kong is actually, and then dinosaurs did exist, but our version of them is still sort of manufactured anyway.
Yeah, sure.
So if you really look into it, so it's like, you know, for all intents and purposes, it's just things we don't know with that they really look like that anyway, so you can accept it more easily on a computer screen. Whereas, like, people in cars, it's like, your eyes pick up on it so much quicker.
Oh,
that
that
it looks fake and cartoony. Because you know what this really looks like. These are real things that exist in our world. So,
good. And this is the finale to the studio tour now, too. It's like, ugh.
Oh, yeah. And then, like, the whole lead-up to it sucked.
Hold on a second.
The acting was awful.
The acting was awful, but the technology was incredible.
Oh, because I was thinking, back to, you passed the Great Outdoors cabin.
Oh, yeah,
and right after that, they start with, like, The Rock comes on.
Oh, that's
the
right.
screen that's on the tram.
I forgot about
and
that.
And does, like, some piss-poor acting.
Oh, yeah, everyone looked like they were just not into this.
But I'm not, like, I mean, I'm a wrestling fan, but, like, I was never a huge Rock fan in wrestling. He was never my favorite. But he was good. He was fine. But I haven't really seen any of his movies. I haven't bothered to. So, like, I had to ask you, like, is he that bad in his films? Like, is he that bad of an actor?
No.
He could be, because he was a wrestler first, so...
He's not the best actor, but he's...
But he was so bad in that video for the tram.
No, but he's fine in the movies.
So he just... He didn't
care. Everyone phoned it in.
He just didn't give a shit.
Big time on this,
didn't bother. He, like, gave him one take and didn't give it. He, like, he was, like, reading off a teleprompter probably during the thing. Like, I doubt he memorized the lines, took the time to do that.
So, that was all bad. But then, the actual... It's funny, they have, like, a pre-show for this part of the studio tour. The whole setup of it and everything was, like, stupid and bad. But the technology was awesome because it's the... I forget the name of it, but it's the same technology that they used on Harry Potter and the queue for Forbidden Journey with the kids. They're supposed to be on the balcony or whatever at one point. And then also in Disaster with Christopher Walken, where he's supposed to come out and talk to you during the pre-show. And they make it look like some sort of projection hologram thing where it looks like they're really there.
Yeah.
They do a very believable job.
There's an actual physical set, and then there's, like, the pre-recorded content with the actors. Yeah, real actors from the movie. And they can somehow project them into the real three-dimensional set, and it looks like they're really there.
Yeah.
And they kind of interact with a couple things, and it is cool.
Oh, yeah, right. Yeah, they do. Ugh. So that part of it was neat to see, but the rest of it was trash, really. Oh, they used that technology on Gringotts, too.
Oh, yes. So disappointing in the sense that it's like I wish they could cancel that Florida ride right now. Do something else.
Yeah.
Well, the thing is, it wasn't as good as Earthquake.
Yeah, that's the thing.
So I'm already kind of calling it, like, I'd rather have Earthquake.
Yeah.
In Florida.
Oh, well.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, well.
All right, anything else with Universal Hollywood?
And that's Universal Studios Hollywood. So, what else we got?
We got Disney.
What's that?
The big D.
You mean we did it? We went?
Believe it or not, we did go.
We did, didn't we?
You can't go to Southern California and skip Disney.
Yeah, you're right.
I know we said this on our Halloween episode, but you just can't.
Can't not go to Disneyland.
Yeah, pretty much.
The original, you gotta do it. So let me just say, that Hatbox Ghost, that's amazing, you know? It is so fucking amazing. I was just like crapping myself when I saw that. It was like, oh my god. Wait, his head's there. No, his head's there. Wait, what? What? Oh my god. Oh my god. Wait, no, turn around. Stop the doom buggy. I want to see that again. Oh god, we're going backwards. We're going, oh no, oh, I'm not going to see it for a while. Okay, we'll go on again, guys, right? All right, all right. You know, I was so excited. Oh, unbelievable. Just head exploded. Way to go, guys. Oh, what a time to be alive. Whew. All right. So, Disneyland. What else we got? Well, is there anything really new? Or it's just sort of like in transition?
Well,
that's the whole thing?
We're not really supposed to talk about this, but you know what? What the fuck? They did let us into Star Wars land. We got a preview, a very special preview.
You're going there.
Oh, I know, we're not supposed to say this, but
we could be in big trouble for this.
They did let us in. We got to take a look around. And, oh boy, are you in for a treat. The attention to detail is off the charts. It's like nothing you've ever seen before.
It's like the construction site was magic. I don't know how they do it, but like even that, right? Like the detail, like the steel beams that are going to become the things, the buildings of this world, even they are like inlaid with magic.
Oh yeah,
the detail on these beams.
Yeah, this is so fresh. This is incredibly,
like the idea is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's so new.
It's like it's so,
they're ahead of themselves.
It's so revolutionary. It's like it'll never be done.
Exactly. It's so revolutionary that it can't possibly be completed because it's always ahead of everything else.
It's I don't know. You gotta get into a time machine or something to be able to experience all of this, because it's just never going to be done. Like literally never going to be done. Like we may or may not live to see it. We got to meet, I don't know, are we supposed to call him Mr. Vader? Or is Darth like his title? I don't know.
Oh.
Or is that his first name? Darthy Pooh? No. He didn't like that.
No, he was pretty serious in person.
Oh,
actually,
he's very serious.
You know, he seems like a cool, laid back guy. You know, in the movies and everything, but you know, in person, he's down to business.
He's got to lighten up a little bit. He's got to, you know, too much stress from one man, one machine man.
Yeah, he should program himself to be a little more relaxed, especially around you know, people that are lining up to see him, fans, true fans.
Well, honestly, the line wasn't that big.
Well,
there was
you
only
got me there.
Really a few people waiting.
Yeah, maybe there's like
I felt a little bad for him.
Yeah.
See, now Chewbacca, he had a much longer line.
Yeah, Chewie's got something going.
But he's got like pizzazz. Like he's got some charisma. You know, you meet him and like, yeah, we met Chewbacca too. That was something else. He was really cool.
Yeah, he gives you a hug. You know, he wants to talk to you. Yeah, he's very nice, very welcoming.
It was very, very fun. Yeah, he's very warm. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Just like a giant overcoat. When you hug
him, he's just right.
Just envelopes you, and it's just so nice.
Yeah, but well, you know, you gotta be careful. You know, he might go in for that kiss. You know, incoming, but then you gotta, you know, do a little maneuver, side swipe. I don't think so.
Wookie slobber.
But
right? I don't know.
You don't want that. But he's very nice otherwise.
Yeah, great guy. All right, so see now the thing is, right now the park is in a bit of transition, so there wasn't so much any new major attraction in the park, right? Am I forgetting anything? No.
Right,
wasn't any one new major attraction right now, but everything's being set up for the eventual Star Wars
land. Right. So right now, the park is shit. It's total garbage. And then once it transitions into Star Wars land, then it's going to be great. But right now, it's just fucking trash.
Then it'll be great. It's what it was always missing.
Yeah. Until Star Wars Land opens, until the greatest thing in the entire universe and beyond opens, we have to contend with what offerings Disneyland does have these days. And one of the things that they did do is they changed the route of the train.
Well, they had to.
Because they have to accommodate Star Wars Land.
Yes.
Now, the leg between Toontown,
New Orleans Square.
Oh, New Orleans Square and Toontown.
And Toontown.
Okay. That's great. That's best leg ever now. Second best leg.
It's still second best in the park. But
it is beautiful. They did a really gorgeous job, actually.
It's better than any leg in World.
Oh, yeah.
Because World's World sucks.
Yeah. No, the rock work they did and the trestle and the whole bit, it's really nice.
It's really cool that you actually stay in the park now.
Yeah.
Instead of riding around backstage, you actually go into the park. And it's nice. I mean, that was always my favorite way to do a train. It's one of the things I loved about Busch Williamsburg. I love how they integrated the train in the park and it interweaves within the lands and in between the rides. And so it's neat to see Disney have at least one section of their train that finally does that. Yeah, so I'm actually for this. It's fine. Star Wars or not, like, I think it's a good idea. It's just kind of neat.
Yeah, it kind of feels like a long time coming, actually.
Yeah. The other thing that they had to change to accommodate this future Star Wars land is the Rivers of America, which I guess was already smaller than World, right? Because everything's smaller in land than World. And, like, now it looks really tiny.
Yeah, that's the one thing. You can see everything from the train now. So I'm not going to say don't do Mark Twain or Columbia, but it makes those less of a thing to do. You don't have to do them because you kind of see everything from the train.
As long as you do one or the other, either train or boat.
And the train is the more fun thing, you know, overall. Right. For me, anyway.
Now on the railroad, you do see the entire backside of the river.
Yeah.
So you see what you would have seen anyway.
So you're not really missing much, if anything.
Yeah. Just in terms of, like, scenery. I guess there's an audio track still on boats.
True, yeah.
A little bit of something. I don't know if anything else special triggers when the boat goes by that you don't see in the train. But, you know, in general, you can see it, though. Yeah, the Rivers of America does seem really small now.
Yeah, I didn't think it would affect it that much, but it is noticeable.
Because, like, it's weird that even when you go to the back of the Hungry Bear and you could, like, see now where the bend, where it's going to start the turnaround already.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, wow, that's it, huh? That's about it.
Yeah, because before it seemed so much bigger, strangely enough. It's funny, though, that little walkway that they added at the back of Hungry Bear, it seems like, it kind of made it seem like it was always there, or like it always should have been there.
Yeah.
It just seems like a natural.
I guess.
I don't know. I like it, though. It's very nice.
Cool. I mean, the reason for that is that's one of the entrances
to
Star Wars, one of the future entrances.
Oh, yeah. By the way, you had pointed this out. The walkways to the entrance to Star Wars Land, why are they not blocked off?
Oh, yeah.
You can walk all the way up to what is the actual entrance to Star Wars
Land. Like what will be, yeah.
Right, but they should be blocked off kind of well before that right now, because they had to put up signs saying, no, this way to Frontierland or this way to Fantasyland or whatever, but like people were getting confused, including us, because it splits off and it looks like the path goes somewhere, but it doesn't. It just goes to a dead end where Star Wars Land will eventually
be.
It'll just
go to like a brown wall.
Yeah, yeah. But right now, just block that off and don't mislead people.
It is weird that the future entrances are open a little longer than they should be, like up to a further on point.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can go too far. You can kind of make, it takes a, you could waste, you know, your legs for a couple minutes, basically.
Yeah.
Taking those extra steps and get down there and then realize that you're going nowhere and turn back.
It's far enough that you cannot see the actual entrance from, you know, the walkway that you should be staying on.
Right. And then, at least the days we were there, they did not have any, like, Star Wars preview stuff or, like, maybe if you're going to use those dead ends to some effect, if you're going to have a stormtrooper standing at each one or have, you know, something to interact with, give you a preview. Maybe they're eventually going to do that.
Disney fucked up here.
When it
they
gets,
should
maybe
have
when
that.
It gets closer, they are going to do that.
All right,
I don't
maybe.
Know. Maybe they'll hear this and get my steal my idea and not give me credit. But, like, do that or have a model, some artwork at each at end of each one or something. But, like, they didn't.
Yeah, they didn't really have anything.
There
yeah.
was nothing at the end of each one, so we did check it out, so... Yeah, that was interesting. That's really all that was new in that park, right? Rivers was shortened.
Well, the other
we didn't do it either, by the way. We didn't do Rivers of America.
Yeah, we actually skipped that.
And we just didn't really have time or that much of a desire, really.
Yeah.
And it looks so small, and like, why would we do this? Yeah. So I don't know how it really functions or how long it even is. It seemed like it'd be really short.
Yeah, the other part of the train that was kind of spruced up is the Grand Canyon diorama. They added some projections in there, which they look really good. That's the best that's ever looked, I think.
They did some good work in there, yeah.
Everything is more kind of alive.
They didn't totally change anything, really. It's all the same stuff. It's all the same foundation, and they kind of added to it.
Built
on it. And yeah, it looked really good. And that's still the best leg of the train, because it's...
Yeah.
It's an attraction in its own right. It's like a dark ride by itself.
Yeah, it really is.
It's fun.
Yeah, it's an amazing thing that's like... It's not advertised very much. You kind of need to be in the know a little bit on that one. Still in 2017, somehow.
Yeah, it's not.
It's like I know they have the poster. You know, the old Disneyland. You know, they do it in the old style, '60s, '50s, '60s style. You know, they'll have it there, like in the park or something. But if you don't know that, then you're gonna miss out on it, which is funny. It's an interesting thing. The only other thing, really, I want to mention when it comes to Disneyland is they changed the seats on the Matterhorn on the trains, and they are much better than they were 5 years ago. Because
is that what they did? Did you look it up?
Well, they
did
had
you
to
research
have.
It?
They okay. had to have. I didn't look it up, but
all right.
they had to have because
they made some kind of tweaks. I don't know what it was. Well, the seats themselves, or
yeah. Well, 5 years ago they swapped out the trains. And to change it to individual seats instead of it being two cars that were just, it was one big open space and you could fit like two, possibly three small people in there. And they all kind of had to sit in each other's laps.
It was like classic log flume style.
Yeah. But whatever it was, you know, 5 or so years ago, they changed it. So now it's three individual seats in each car, six total to one whole train. And back then the seats were very hard. It was so uncomfortable. It really destroyed that ride. I was really sad about that because it made that unrideable. It was like, oh, we like lost Matterhorn, at least for now, because those trains suck. But sometime between then and now, they padded the seats and that ride is back in action. It's great again.
All right. I don't know if it was that. I mean, I also, there was some kind of cutouts to put your feet.
Oh, did they not have that?
So you could sink your feet lower. I don't remember if they did or not.
Okay.
But I kind of felt like that was one of the other problems. Like, you didn't have a good place to put your legs before.
Possibly.
It was more awkward, and I think they made that better. They made an improvement there. So, either way, it was improved.
So, yeah, that's great to see.
Yeah, Matterhorn was back. Yeah, and the effects changes they made were great.
Oh, yes. New Yeti animatronic.
The new lift.
So good.
The new lift effect was great.
Oh, and that,
the
yeah.
The Yeti
that's,
behind
yeah,
the too. Ice instead of just the snow.
Yeah.
The falling snow. Yeah. And then, yeah, the new animatronic Yetis are just...
Yeah, just rawr, yeah.
Just like when he just turns his head at you or like, shaking his head up, back and forth.
And, yeah, it's like, it looks kind of like more real than it should, I think, because you're going by it so fast.
Yeah.
You're going by it like at like just the right speed, and the animatronic has like just the right amount of fluid movement and stuff that it's like disturbingly real looking. I don't know, somehow.
Yeah, it looks like a real beast is after you.
Yeah.
It's pretty neat.
They really got it on that one.
So that ride is just running better than ever, I think. It's really, really yeah. a great time on that.
Oh, so good.
Do it at night, by the way.
Do it at night.
That's my recommendation. It's and, such a great night ride.
If you're looking sort of at the front of it, where you enter into the front of it, right side better than left side, right? We finally determined that.
Yeah. We like the right side better, the yeah. right track.
Yeah. Because I always thought they were pretty equal, but no, I think there is
at least,
a
at least this
there.
Time, yeah, the left was running a little rougher. Didn't yeah. seem as good.
Okay. Is that it for Disneylander?
Well, that reminded me, we just talked about Matterhorn, Thunder Mountain had that one new effect scene.
Oh, right, yeah.
That reminded me of that. The third and final lift on that ride got some new effects. It's like, it's a bit much, actually.
A little bit.
They added, I guess, exploding dynamite, basically, all around you. But it's like, it's just so, it's constant. As soon as you pull into that tunnel and then you start going up the lift, there's just like constant explosions all around you. And they did a good job. It's you see like the flame moving through the fuses, to like one from one stick of dynamite to the next, and you see that happening, and then it's just constant like in your ears.
Yeah. Oh, it's very loud too. It's actually too loud.
Yeah. It's like yeah, it's like too. Well, it's still not close to I guess the real decibel
well,
level.
No,
real
yeah.
dynamite would actually make you go deaf for at least for a minute.
Yeah.
But still, yeah, it's like kind of too loud, and then. And there's some cool, like, bursts of steam that go along with the explosions, and that's cool. And then the rocks move. Well, the rocks always moved.
Yeah.
That was already in there, but now there's all this other shit going on. It's neat. And then the problem is it lacks a final payoff, though.
Yeah.
Like, they didn't do... There's no fire.
No.
You know, it all comes down to the fuses are going up to, like, the final... Where there's a... it's all, like, single sticks of dynamite. And then there's, like, a final, like, payload of dynamite at the top. I guess the old effect was like there was more track up there, right? And then the track was broken.
Yeah.
Like you're supposed to keep going up and then you're going to veer off and go down. And then you don't really drop, though. You just gently get, you know, sent into like a curve. But anyway. And now it's like a payload of dynamite up there. But then it's like there should be like a final. There should be fire.
Should be fire and or
a big
blast of fog.
A shitload of smoke.
Something, yeah.
And
there's just
instead,
nothing.
There's
just a projection of like. The thing kind of exploding, right?
Was it a projection? There might have actually been a final burst of steam.
Whatever it was,
but it
wasn't
too
enough.
Small. It wasn't like, yeah, it was like small, and it was I forget what the situation was. Like, we didn't see it the first time or two because we were more in the middle of the train, maybe. Like, only the back sees it, maybe? Oh, is that what it was?
That's right. Yeah, I think we got the very back. I'm totally right, yeah.
The whole train doesn't get to see it. Like, only the back sees the little steam. Like, the front half to two-thirds of the train sees nothing change. Like, yeah. You're waiting for some final big effect in that moment, in that spot, and then nothing happens. And then the back just gets, like, a little burst of steam, though, but no fire or anything. It should be more. It's not a good payoff to that tunnel. So you put up with all this noise, and then, like, you don't get a final payoff. It's just, it's a cool idea, but I don't know. It needs a little some tweaking.
It does, yeah.
To the execution of it. Of course, all the effects look amazing. I mean, it is Disney. It's Disney quality.
Oh, yeah.
But it's just, yeah, it needs a little something.
Yeah, and that ride was running, like, better than ever. You know, they keep that ride
the ride
up
itself?
So well.
Oh, yeah, it's running great. And then Jones had a couple upgrades since we've last seen it, too. And it needed it. It needed a little something.
Yeah.
So it's better. It still needs, like, a little more, something more.
Yeah.
It needs a couple more things, too. They need to, like, go back in and just, like, add a couple things.
I think it's still sort of caught in between being cutting edge and being, like, distinguished.
Well, you mean
era.
Like, what, like, classic status?
Yeah.
Like, it's going to be, like, another Haunted Mansion or
right.
Pirates?
Yeah, it's moving towards that.
Yeah.
But it's not quite there yet.
It's still a little too new.
Yeah.
We're talking about Indiana Jones and the Temple of the Forbidden Eye.
So it's still, like, partially just kind of dated looking and then, yeah, partially classic. It's not full classic status yet.
Yeah, but they added a bunch of projections in the beginning.
Yeah.
So they really made that look a little more modern.
They did that. But they, at least in our visit, the three doors thing in the very beginning was not working. It was always the middle door you were going through.
Yeah, it wasn't shifting.
You know what? That's such a dumb thing anyway. I don't even know why they did that to begin with. Because who the hell even notices that?
Yeah, you gotta write it a bunch of times.
Pointless.
Really to notice that.
Yeah, who cares about, like, oh, there's three different riches you could possibly get? Who cares? Nobody notices that. I had to look that up.
Yeah, it doesn't do anything for the ride. They had a bunch of projections. The
Jones animatronic was different, right?
Yeah, it was a different position.
Yeah.
Than what it used to be. So I assume it's a new animatronic.
Yeah.
Or they just, like, totally rebuilt the one that was there. It used to be holding the doors back with his back, right?
Yeah.
And now he's more doing it with his shoulder facing the doors, kind of.
Mm.
And then, you know, it seemed like the audio was crisper, maybe a little louder. They probably did, like, a sound system upgrade, I would imagine.
Yeah.
And the lighting was a little more enhanced all around, I think. They probably upgraded a lot of the lighting. So that was neat. It's still great. It's still my favorite thing there in that park.
Well, yeah, it's still the ride that we end on.
It's still our finale. It's still our main event at a day at Disneyland. That's amazing, but it still is.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess there's just a couple dead parts in the middle.
A couple of turns,
a couple of dead parts, and we're both pretty sure there was always like that, right? The ride was always like that.
I did research afterwards, and that's just the way it always was, as far as I can tell.
But that's what I'm talking about. Like, they almost, why not go back in now and add some shit?
Sure, yeah, why not? There's no reason not to. Yeah,
I don't know what kind of space you have, you know, off to the side on those rooms, but you know, it's gotta be a little something you could do.
Yeah.
All right. So is that Disneyland now?
I guess that's Disneyland. No, California Adventure had some more new stuff.
Yes, the park is still open.
We missed Soarin 2.0, whatever the hell it's called these days. Whatever. You had seen it already. I had not. I don't care.
Yeah, I did it. We talked about it on the show.
Yeah. So then we got Luigi's Rollickin' Roadsters.
Oh, that was new for us. That's right.
Yeah, because we did the original Flying Tires, and that
was boy.
Crap. That didn't work at all.
It was just as bad as you've read or heard other people talk about.
Yeah, you couldn't move.
Yeah, it was crap.
Yeah, so now they do.
They had to try the same failed concept twice.
Yes, that's right. So now they do a pre choreographed dance thing where you sit in the car and music plays and it does a dance while you're in the car.
Yeah, the cars dance.
It's cool to see off the ride. When you're on the ride, it's crap.
Yeah, it's
better. Really not
off
any better than what was there. It's actually really jerky. The movements were not fluid.
It's still better than what was there. At least it's like something that works.
All right, at least you get a show off the ride.
Yeah.
Because everything does look cool. The technology is cool because it's all trackless.
Yeah, you don't see anything.
Yeah, all these ride cars are in sync with each other doing... It really is dancing. Like, they do twirls and, like, do-si-dos and whatever the hell, you know, swing your partner and all that kind of, stuff. Like, line dancing, you know, too. And that's neat to see. But when you're on it, it's like you can't really see that, and you're just kind of getting jerked around.
Yeah, the actual ride does... It's not smooth. And the best is the finale, where it does the spin.
That's the only thing, yeah.
You get a little spin cycle in the end, and that's fun. But in the end, it's like, just ride a scrambler. It's so much more satisfying just having that motion for a minute and a half. I don't know. It's a weird idea. I think I said it when we got off there. I was like, all right, I can't wait to see what's here next time we come back. So I feel like they're just going to keep changing it, because it's every one of these things is a big failure.
It definitely had that feel, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if this will last forever either. It's, we'll see. It's to be seen. It might, though, because I guess as long as they don't have mechanical issues with it. All right, what else was new?
Guardians of the Galaxy.
What, did we talk about this already?
We talked about it a little bit, but we didn't really get into
That's kind of the wrong order, though.
Yeah. Well, you know, Tower of Terror overlay.
You never know.
Yeah, the shit they put on the outside of that building looks really kind of bad in person. When you get up close to it.
I hear they went to the new used ride Emporium on this one. I think that's how they got some of the stuff. They may have did the actual design for this. I think so. It's a rumor. I don't know.
Okay, listen. Neither one of us have seen the Guardians of the Galaxy movies. So I don't know how much this looks like the stuff in the films. But even still, in person... It looks haphazard, but it also was just kind of cheap, because a bunch of stuff was just painted on, which I was really surprised to see.
Yeah, it looked like it was done on the cheap. We were essentially just complaining the whole time we were waiting. Yes. We had to wait for it a little bit. So, I mean, I guess this sort of worked, right? Because we never had to wait for Tower of Terror in that park.
That's true.
Besides maybe the lobby. But this is the first time we ever really waited in that outer courtyard area.
Yeah.
At all.
At least for now. Yeah, I mean, people are checking it out again.
So we were out there, and then as we were just going back and forth in the switchbacks, we were looking up, and it just looks so crappy.
It was shocking, kind of how cheap it looked.
I mean, we said it on our preview when this was announced show. We talked about this particular attraction. You know, it's stupid. It's like, it's Tower of Terror. It still looks like that. It's the same exact shape.
Yeah.
And, I'm pretty sure there was there couldn't have been a building in the movie that looked exactly like this.
Yeah, it's hard to imagine.
Unless they knew they were going to do this, but I don't think they did. They couldn't have.
Yeah.
So it's like, this is stupid. Just really shoehorning this in.
Yeah.
And then on top of that, they didn't even do it really great. It's cheap.
Yeah, and the black strip. That large black strip down the middle of it makes it look unfinished, too.
Yeah, it's that weird, almost unfinished portion. Yeah, the stuff that is there just looks like... You could just tell even from a distance that it's like plastic. Yeah, it's just all just like molded fiberglass and plastic. And then
yeah.
That is definitely sub-Disney quality.
It was.
Yeah. It looked like...
It wasn't even Universal quality. No. It was like Bush quality. Bush,
yeah. It looked like Bush did their version of Tower of Terror.
Yeah, yeah.
And
yeah.
That's like what they would come up with. Like the Pantopia thing.
Yeah.
The space junk. They put the space junk on that that theater in Concrete Town.
Yeah,
that became Pantopia in Tampa's Busch Gardens. It's like that. It's like just some dumb space junk on Tower of Terror. And then when you're down, the actual courtyard where you are, it's like a lot of it looked like it was not even really changed. They just painted the stucco, and then I'm pretty sure some of the light fixtures were the same ones.
You know what?
Left a lot of that the same.
This is I don't know, maybe this is the most overlay I've ever seen. It was so thinly overlaid. It was shocking.
Yeah, it's just really weird. So, that part wasn't any better than I thought it would be. Like we kind of panned this already in our pre-review, and it was the same thing.
Pre-review.
You know, you walk in, and it's I don't know, it's a bunch of screens, you know.
Yeah, Benicio del Toro, which I actually didn't know.
Oh, that was funny. the statue outside when you first enter the queue, and then you're like, I don't think, you didn't say anything at the time, But you said you thought, like, that looks like Benicio del Toro.
Well, yeah, and seeing pictures and stuff, I always thought, like, always, I mean, this has only been open for a little bit, but, you know, I thought, kind of looks like Benicio del Toro. That's weird. And then it really is him.
And it's because it is him. He plays that character.
I had no idea.
Yeah, he plays the villain in the movie, apparently. Who knew?
Yeah.
We didn't know.
So anyway, you do the pre-show thing in the regular pre-show room, but the raccoon comes in there and, you know, watch a video if you want to see, you know, what the hell happens. But here's what the bottom line is. They came up with the best ride drop program ever for that ride.
Okay, yeah.
That's what it comes down to. The theme and all the screens that they added in there for, you know, when the doors actually open up for the... It's a gantry now. It's not an elevator.
It's a gantry lift.
The gantry lift. It opens up and there's just screens and it's just a bunch of shit in your face. It's chaos. I have no idea what the hell's going on.
Yeah.
But the drop program is awesome.
Well, it's like, yeah, you know, the theme, the queue, the old other Disney ride props that they put in the queue.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, the screen's on the ride. It's fucking Batista. It's like, all that shit can go fuck itself.
Yeah.
But what a fucking drop ride, right?
Yeah.
I mean, come on. That's all that really matters.
It was so weird, too, because I wasn't expecting that. I was expecting them to, like, tone it down. But
yeah.
No, they just, like, amped it up and made it the best dropper out there. Or, you know, the best drop program between the Tower of Terrors.
Yeah, they did. It's like more extreme than ever. More drops than ever. It just...
Oh, yeah. So many drops. It's crazy. It feels like it goes on forever.
It feels like it's longer, too, than it used to be. I don't know if it really is.
Yeah.
Maybe. Well, you know what it might be? It's longer dropping time, I think. Because they cut out the theatrical slow build, the beginning of the Tower of Terror. Even that version had it.
Yeah.
You know, where you weren't dropping yet. You were just going up one level, then the next. And you,
that's right. Yeah.
A couple scenes before you started dropping. And they just dispense with that. You just kind of start right away. Just
All right, it kicks right into.
Here we go.
Well, yeah,
and
because
being pulled up and down like crazy.
Right, as soon as those doors close, you see the shadow of the raccoon saying like, "All right, let's do this." And then just the ride starts right up. Oh, okay.
So yeah, it's like it is just all chaos and whatever. But it's like if you don't really give a shit, which we don't, about the movie and these characters and whatever, it's like it's just a lot of fun because the program's so great. And then like. Doing it to like a pop song is like it's fine. It's just it's kind of fun.
Yeah,
it's
sure.
Like a party atmosphere while you're riding this awesome ride.
Yeah. Well, it was. I mean, we did it. Whatever it was, Monsters After Dark, when it was some original soundtrack, and the ride was still just as much fun.
Yeah.
So, in the end, I don't know. Maybe it evens out. Maybe even this version is a teensy bit better because the actual ride portion of it is better.
Yeah. You know what?
It's like the theme is not as good, but like the actual ride is a little bit better, so it kind of evens out in the end.
It's like the whole overlay thing kind of makes me sick, but you're right. It's like it probably is a better overall ride now.
Yeah, strangely enough.
So this is actually an improvement.
So you know, thematically, no, it's a disaster. Not just you know in terms of it being kind of a cheap job. But what is it doing in Hollywood Land and a California themed park? No,
oh,
it makes
yeah.
sense.
With like
in that respect.
The red trolley going out in front of it and everything. And it's
yeah.
Like...
But the ride, just the pure ride itself is like better than it's ever been.
All right. What else you got?
That's really kind of it
okay.
for California Adventure. I mean, You're I just want to say the only other thing I really want to say is man, California Screamin' is such a great ride.
Yeah. We had
How many
time
times did we do that?
Like good four or five.
Five or something? Yeah. Oh, so good.
Mm-hmm.
Love that ride.
Yeah, because I think I've forgotten in the 5 years like how much I liked it.
It's like, yeah, I always knew it was a solid ride, but this was like better than I remembered.
Yeah, it's still running great, and it's just a fun ride.
Yeah,
it is really great.
It's so long, and it does like everything it does on there, it does well.
Yeah,
really
it's
good.
It's a great
really.
Ride. It is a great ride.
Yeah, that's really it, I think. The only thing left... is
what
we did do it.
What did we do?
We did Max Pass.
Oh,
we got to experience it.
You want to go into that now?
Well, we got it because we ponied up for it.
Oh, we did.
$10 a piece.
Yeah,
only cost you $10 a piece.
Yeah, I guess you that really did. That line is totally apt here.
We were tight on time. Jesus, there's just so much to do.
Yeah.
You know, between Disneyland and California Adventure.
It doesn't matter when you go, by the way. It's like middle of the week, late September. It's still jam-packed.
Yeah. It's hard to squeeze everything in.
That place is impossible.
So we opted to get MaxPass for one of the days.
Our last day there. We saved the money up.
And what do you think? How was your experience doing FastPass on your phone and that whole thing?
It was convenient. Yeah, so I was the group leader, and I was the one who brought my phone in and made the FastPass group and did all that on my phone. You know, I brought my phone in the other 2 days too before this, just to see like wait times. You don't have to worry about finding a board in the park with the wait times or anything, or go from ride to ride. And that's convenient. And they were pretty much always accurate. The wait times are still, they're not always totally accurate, the actual wait times. But the app is at least syncing up to the park.
Yeah.
Well, sure. It wasn't like the app was a half hour behind or an hour behind. I found that it was always like accurate to what they were reporting otherwise. Mm. So that was good. And then the MaxPass part of it, I kind of liked it. You know, I'm dancing around it here, but you know, and the reason I liked it, and I know it's still very different than what they're doing in Disney World in Florida, is because essentially it still is the old system. It's just that you can do it on your phone instead of having to walk to the distribution area, like off to the side of the entrance, or in some cases, especially in land, because they were so tight on space. In some cases, like the distribution area is like in a really weird spot away from the actual attraction, and you have to just know where it is. Instead of having to do that, now you can make the reservations on your phone. But otherwise, in every way, it's still the old system. There's no pre-reservations. You have to be in the park. So you have to have scanned your ticket for the first time that day before you'll be able to actually reserve any fast passes. So once you scan your ticket, I think you could like leave the park for a while and you can go to the Carl's Jr. down the street and you could reserve one if it was time to do so. But you have to at least have been at the park once already that day. So you can't go too far. There's no bullshit, you know, 180 days out for resort guests and then, you know, all these different tiers, like basically splitting everybody up into classes, all that bullshit that is happening at Walt Disney World. You don't have to have your day planned out, you know, months in advance, which I don't like. So it's, you know, you just still just go there for the day, but now you just, instead of jackassing around to the different rides and crisscrossing the park even more than you already do just to get to the rides to ride them, you know, you can actually just do it on your phone. And like I was able to do, as long as we all paid our $10, then I was able to make the reservation for all three of us on my phone every time.
And you get more often, right?
And it does seem like the window closes a bit when you do it this way. And, I mean, it helps because you don't have to waste the time to now walk to the next distribution area. So that saves you some time there. Also, and then also, too, you can be a little more picky and choosy. When you had to walk to the distribution center, you know, once you got there, even if the time was like a few hours away and maybe later than you wanted it to be, the return window time, you would maybe just take it anyway because, like, well, we walked over here just for this purpose. What are we gonna do? Keep walking around the whole rest of the park? Like, let's just get this one. Where now on the phone, it's like you can scan through and you can see what the return window for every ride right now is. And then maybe you take one with a return window that's only like a half hour away. And then you get that one, you use it, and then you save your big, whatever, the Indiana Jones adventure, which is usually one of the more popular ones, Space Mountain. And then you can use those more strategically when you're finally ready. But without locking up your ability to get more fast passes so soon in the day. And then so it does enable you to strategize even more within the old system and actually get more out of it. So for only $10, I mean, and I'm sure it will continue to go up like everything does there. Yeah. So like one day it'll be like 30 and then it'll be 40 I don't know. But right now for just $10 and the amount of
$10 a piece.
The amount, $10 a person, but still, and the amount of convenience that it gave. It was nice. I liked it. I still should be free. It should just be the way you can use fast passes now.
Yes.
Of course. I mean, I'm not going to defend them that they need more money. They don't.
This should just be like the progression of technology.
It should just be the way it is. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. You have to pay for this. That's bullshit.
And then it's funny because then they still have the paper fast passes for everybody else, but they kind of don't
No,
and you don't find that out until you're there. At least we didn't, because I guess we didn't read up enough on it. Now they're just reminders, the actual paper, and you still, it's still just something that's loaded into your park ticket.
Right, you need your park ticket, and that was jamming up the fast pass lines because nobody realized that, including us the first time.
Yeah, we were so confused. And then so that's almost like a penalty now, because then when you know about it, and or you do the max pass and you pay for that, then you just have the barcode come up right up on your phone and you scan that, which is actually more convenient.
Yeah. So the way it is right now, yeah, I'm actually kind of down with it. I mean, yeah, I don't like that you have to pay for it. That is bullshit. But I do like that it is really the same system. It's just that you can, you don't have to physically walk to the thing. That's really it.
But, you know, the thing is, as we know from history, they're never going to stop tweaking it. And
no.
They'll eventually ruin it.
And you were looking at your phone a lot more.
Oh.
Or, I mean, you would never bring your phone
Well,
in.
Normally I don't bring my phone
to
the parks.
Yeah, so you were looking at your phone quite a bit.
I was.
To check wait times and to reserve fast passes and all this stuff.
Sure.
How did you feel about that part of it?
I don't know. I it was okay. For this time, this visit. No, I don't feel like I missed out on anything. You know, it's all relative. You know, this is like, I mean, like that last, we did it on the third day. We went 3 days. We used all 3 days of our hopper. It was the third day in Disney this time around. So, like, I've spent a total of, I think it's been like three days every time. So maybe this is like my total, like, 12th or 13th day ever, like, in that park. I mean, it's been like, you know, I've been there a lot. So that helps.
Mm.
You know, if it was my first time, you know, and then, and you're going in with the, looking at the phone a lot, yeah, you know, you might miss some stuff. I mean, I guess if you don't know what you're missing, but it's kind of a shame still. You know, you should have your head up and be looking around. It's a lot of details. Right.
That's what it's there for, yeah.
Fucking Disneyland. It's,
yeah,
so much history.
It's funny. It's like, if there's one park where you don't want to have your face buried in a phone, it's that park.
Yeah.
And they're kind of forcing you to do that.
But, you know, but for me, like, I have seen it all already. And I wasn't in my phone so much that I didn't see things.
All right.
You know, I feel like I saw everything I wanted to see. At this point, because I know kind of what's going on, so I know what I want to look for.
Okay.
In each queue and in each area, and what I want to see again, like old friends.
Yeah.
You see them again. It's fun.
So MaxPass, okay, right now at least.
Yeah, for now. All right.
All right. And anything else?
The Red Rose Tavern. We tried that.
Oh, we tried that.
Food was all right.
Yeah, fine.
Oh, what was our best meal though?
No, but Disneyland Resort food overall better than was 5 years ago. It's very good actually now.
Now, that's funny. It was always better than Walt Disney World.
Oh, it was always so much better. And now it's like
the
it's almost Bush quality.
Quick service we're talking about.
Yeah, the quick service. It's like just a little notch below Bush.
Oh, okay. You go that far.
It's very good. Yeah.
Yeah, it was very good. I like what they were trying to do with that Red Rose Tavern. That was
The meatloaf we had.
A couple
at,
interesting things. But no, that was the best. I thought that was the best
French market.
Meal. French market.
With that peppercorn sauce? Oh, man, that was delicious.
The Cajun meatloaf.
Oh, and the corn chowder was good,
was
too.
Was delicious, and the corn chowder in the bread bowl. The bread was, the sourdough.
Yeah, oh, that's
was amazing.
Right. Very good.
That was our best in-park meal there.
Yeah, really good.
And we tried the new Mexican, the, like, pop-up Mexican.
Oh, like the temporary for Coco.
Yeah, the movie Coco. In California Adventure.
I thought that was good. I had the tamales. That was delicious.
Yeah, that was okay. That wasn't my favorite.
All right.
So that's Disneyland. Fucking Disneyland. It gets you.
Yeah.
Tugs at your heartstrings and just, it gets you. That's Disney to me. It's better than Florida.
Yeah.
I'd rather go to California than Florida.
Yeah, it'll get you every time. It really will. Yeah.
But now I'm not going for at least a few months. What are you going to do? Where else are you gonna go, really, you know? All right. So that was it. That was everything else new we did in California.
Yeah, that's California 2017. New stuff, past 5 years.
Thanks
for
riding from heaven to hell.